watching Fox Sports, home to Major League Baseball, the National Football League, NASCAR, and the new home of the BCS. This is America's number one sports network.
For anyone that likes the water and nice weather, South Florida is the place to be. I can go out my front door and scuba dive in crystal clear water, or get on one of my boats and catch a variety of fish. Being the confluence of America, South Florida's got a variety of ethnic groups, so it's an exciting atmosphere. Welcome and enjoy.
In a place known for fun under the sun, the underbelly is guarded by devilish deacons and meek birds of prey. With attacks on the offensive, these two are the last line of defense. It's Miami Nice, starring the Art Deco Demon Deacon and the Collins Avenue Cardinal. Together, they go deep undercover with no time for games, and fear is simply not an option. They'll use any means necessary to capture their goal, and they always look good. As the sun sets, the niceness is gone and the duel begins. Miami Nice is now Miami Mean. They arrive together, but only one leaves a champion.
The Built For Tough BCS pregame show on Fox is sponsored by Blockbuster Total Access, now offering movies through the mail plus movies through the store.
Operating on the affairs of mankind, none is greater than that of competition. Author Henry Clay.
Tostitos Bowl Bash continues tonight from Miami, the FedEx Orange Bowl, the Louisville Cardinals, and the Wake Forest Demon Deacons. And Happy New Year. Welcome to South Florida. Matt Vasgersian joined by one of the voices of Notre Dame football on NBC, Pat Hayden, and Hall of Famer Terry Donahue. Coach, we start with you. A big act to follow tonight after the late magic of the Tostitos Fiesta Bowl yesterday. The ACC champs, the Big East champs tonight. Break it down for us.
Well, Louisville's a great offensive football team, and they can generate an awful lot of points. If Wake Forest is going to win, they've got to play great defense, and they have to play well early. They kind of have to absorb that Louisville offensive team. It's a shock and awe offense. And I think you do that by keeping the ball in front of you, not giving up big plays. Make Louisville work for everything they get. If you play good defense and you have a good kicking game when you're a heavy underdog like Wake Forest, you can win this football game.
All right, well, we'll turn to our quarterback to talk about quarterback play tonight. Couple of good ones on the field tonight, Pat.
Indeed. But, you know, really different styles. They're asked to do much different things in their respective offenses. Brian Brohm, the University of Louisville quarterback in his junior, he is asked really to carry the offense, sometimes win the game. Battled through some injuries, finished the season very strongly, 10 touchdown passes the last three games. I think those were his best throws, where he's throwing the ball deep downfield and attacking, and boy, does he have a bevy of good receivers. His counterpart from Wake Forest, Riley Skinner, started the season as the third team quarterback, but led them to an 11-2 record. Unconventional offense, running a lot of reverses. Riley out leading the way there, as you see. 70 runs by the wide receiver, so indeed it is unconventional. But kind of following up on Terry's theme, I think Riley needs to get off to a very good start in the terms of possessing the ball, keeping the ball away from Louisville, trying to make this a close game going into the fourth quarter where they've won four games in the last minute.
All right, to get things started on the field tonight, we send it to our public address announcer, John Magrino.
Ladies and gentlemen, we ask that you please remain standing as Grammy Award winner CeCe Winans performs our national anthem.
Oh, can you see by the dawn's early light was so proudly we hailed at the twilight last gleam? Whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight o'er the rampart we watched were so gallantly streaming and the rocket reckless the bombs burst. Still there, oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave?
Welcome back to South Florida, the 73rd annual Orange Bowl, about ready to get set. The heavy favorites, the Louisville Cardinals, the powers out of the Big East, the number two overall offense in the nation. Louisville was supposed to be here. The guys coming out of the tunnel after them, well, they can't claim the same thing. And we've talked about matchups that pit small programs, small schools against the Giants. We saw one of them yesterday. This, folks, on paper is every bit what the Tostitos Fiesta Bowl was last night. Here come the Louisville Cardinals. Time to check in with the fourth member of our broadcast team, Laura Oakman.
Thanks, Matt. I'm here with Coach Bobby Petrino, and all you've had is a month to think about it, to talk about it, to get ready for it. What's the last thing you told your guys coming out here, Coach?
We just got to come out and play Louisville Cardinal football, get started fast and play the game the way it's supposed to be played, very physical, by the rules, from whistle to whistle.
With so much adversity this year, you've said throughout the season, we need to find our identity. Who do you want to see tonight?
I want to see our offense get out, start fast, get the ball in the end zone, and our defense really play fast, and hopefully we can force them to throw the ball so we can get after the quarterback.
You ready for this game?
I'm ready to go.
Get out of here.
Thank you.
Good luck.
All
Matt,
right, Laura,
back to you.
Thank you. And moments ago, we had a chance to listen in the Wake locker room and head coach Jim Grobe.
All right, guys, I'm proud of you. I love you. Play hard tonight, man. Play like your hair's on fire tonight. Take care of the football on offense. Nothing bigger than the kicking game tonight. Defense, fly around, play with a lot of pride. Let's go to work. Here we go.
The Wake Forest Demon Deacon. Very special coin toss and kickoff coming up next.
As the title sponsor of the FedEx Orange Bowl for the past 18 years, FedEx has a long history and special connection with college football. To reach the FedEx Orange Bowl, Wake Forest and Louisville have exhibited sustained excellence throughout the season. This level of commitment and performance resonates deeply with FedEx, as each of our team members brings incredible pride to the challenge of making every FedEx experience outstanding. We congratulate Wake Forest and Louisville on their success in 2006 and invite you to enjoy the game.
Great athletic achievement come together for this once-in-a-lifetime moment. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome South Florida's own Dwayne Wade, Wake Forest University's honorary captain and golf great Arnold Palmer, along with the University of Louisville's honorary captain, sportsman of the century, and the greatest of all time, Muhammad Ali.
Lady with the pink.
Wake Forest has won the toss, and Jim Grobe has already pulled an upset. He told some people before this thing that if he won the toss, he would play defense. Instead, he elects to receive the football, so Bobby Petrino's Cardinals will kick it away. And some of the magic of the FedEx Orange Bowl, we haven't even started the game yet. And these BCS games are nothing if not all about great pageantry and moments, and we haven't even begun the game before we had a great one tonight. Well, how'd they get here? Let's talk about the Wake Forest and Louisville runs to the Orange Bowl. Times were sweet in the bill this season. The Cards enjoyed the finest year in school history. The headline act, the Brian Brohm fueled offense, 39 points a game, third in the country. The Cards scored 44 in their biggest win of the season, a top five showdown with West Virginia. Wake enjoyed the biggest turnaround in the nation, thanks in large part to freshman quarterback Riley Skinner. The Deacs defense was equally stellar, harassing quarterbacks and leading the nation in interceptions. And a month ago today, Wake Forest outdueled Georgia in the ACC championship game, winning their first conference title since 1970. Guys, there are underdogs, and then there are underdogs. And I think we'd all agree that Wake is a big-time underdog here tonight.
But, you know, interesting that Jim Grobe didn't accept the ball when he won the toss. He told us just a couple of days ago he was going to start off with it, defer, get it the second half, and he wants to really put some pressure on Louisville right now. Even if they just get a few first downs, maybe a field goal, get this thing started, and try to take care of that onslaught of a Louisville offense, Terry, that you talked about.
Well, Pat, I think it's a good move by Jim Grobe, and I think he wants to keep Louisville's offensive team off the field as much as he can tonight. As you mentioned, a couple first downs, punt the ball, play field position. That's what you do when you're a heavy underdog.
Boy, it rained most of the afternoon here today. 73 degrees, humid, a chance of rain throughout the night. It is an SEC officiating crew on the field for the 73rd annual FedEx Orange Bowl this evening, as the Louisville Cardinals are set to kick it away to get us going. Tom Ritter is our referee tonight.
It was interesting. We heard Jim Grobe in the locker room, Matt, as he addressed his team, said, "Hey, guys, play like your hair's on fire, and the kicking game is going to win it for us. And it starts right here as they receive this kickoff."
And he also said, take care of the football. That's how Wake Forest has survived all season long, with their turnover margin, their kicking game, and playing good defense. They've got to take care of that football tonight. Let Louisville be the team that turns it over. That's how they get the upset.
One of the two Cardinals kickers, Todd Flannery, set to kick it away. And the 73rd annual FedEx Orange Bowl is underway from Miami. This is Kevin Marion trying to stay in bounds and doing so unsuccessfully as his momentum carried him out at the 12. So Riley Skinner and the Wake offense will begin the day at the 12-yard line, and Skinner, the ACC Rookie of the Year, one of the best stories in college football. As you mentioned at the top, Pat, he was number 3 on the depth chart on opening day, but injuries and necessity forced Skinner in there, and you fast forward to January, and he's had a fantastic year.
You know, incredibly accurate, 66% completion rate, won 11 games.
Kenneth Moore and Rich Beltner in the backfield with Skinner. The Jacksonville native will take it out of the shotgun, hand it to Kenneth Moore, the converted wideout, and he is stuffed immediately by Amobi Okoye. Let's meet Wake Forest up front. All-American senior Steve Vallos has started every game in his career. He'll play both sides of the line, and they've done a great job keeping the redshirt freshman QB clean. Backs and receivers, almost everybody carries the ball here. Yeah. Wake has more players with over 150 rushing yards than any other Division I-A team in the country.
Yeah, you know, they've run a lot of reverses, misdirection. Some play teams call them trick plays, but this is part of the Wake offense.
After a pickup of 1, 2nd and 9 now. Skinner with a little time, and the pass is caught by Nate Morton, breaking a tackle. First down, Demon Deacons. Finally forced out of bounds by Nate Harris. Let's meet Louisville's defensive front. 39 sacks, second in the nation. They're led by the man you just saw, the 19-year-old senior and unanimous All-Big East first-teamer, Amobi Okoye. The linebackers, Nate Harris, the Cardinals' leading tackler. Among the 23 Floridians on the roster, he's the only Miami native. And in the secondary, Cards lost senior corner Gavin Smart to a broken leg in practice this week, so Rod Council gets a start in the secondary. A fumble in the backfield. Okay. Willie Idelet moving backwards, and he's taken down at the five.
You know, Terry, I think you worry about bowl games. It's like really an opening game. Again, you know, you've been off for an entire month, and even though this is part of their offense, they've been doing this all year, it's like an opening game, and you worry about the miscues.
Well, it looks like it's a perfect handoff, really, and you're right, Pat. After you've laid off a while, you accumulate some rust,
yeah.
And you got to get that rust off you. Certainly, this kind of a position for Wake Forest's offense puts them behind the eight ball. This is a difficult place to be for them. They don't want to be in long yardage situations.
They're in a second and 29 now. Up the middle is Rich Belton, the fullback. Ball comes loose.
Called it down, I believe.
Whistle dead, however, at the 20-yard line. Nate Harris made the hit that popped the ball free.
Well, Wake Forest has gotten off to a very rough start. They mishandled the opening kickoff. Should have let it gone out of bounds. Here you can see the runner is clearly down before the ball comes out, but they've already had loose balls all over the field. And one of the last things Jim Grobe told his team, take care of the football, right?
Yeah, you're right. And, you know, in Louisville is just as aggressive on defense, Matt. You mentioned the 39 sacks by 17 different players. This is a down they can really get after Riley Skinner.
Louisville's got the nickel package on the field. They have been very good on third down defense. Blitz gets picked up. Skinner throws. He's got a man, and the reception made at the 45 by Willie Idelet.
I think the toughest thing for a quarterback to do, Terry, is just kind of hang in there in the pocket in the midst of all those bodies flying around and blitzes and rushes. And Riley Skinner did just that. And Idelet, a little corner route. And again, Riley Skinner doesn't necessarily have a gun for an arm, but boy, is he accurate.
And what a great throw. Either Idelet catches the ball or nobody catches the ball. A perfect throw by Riley Skinner.
Willie Idelet had the big reception that set up the game-winning field goal versus Georgia Tech in the ACC championship game. So a big third down conversion by the Wake offense. Here's Skinner out of the shotgun once again. Pass rush is coming. And under pressure, Skinner's able to dump it off. Abe Brown, the guy that came in off that outside linebacker corner.
Yeah, Abe Brown ran right through Kenny Moore. We talked about Kenny Moore playing running back, number 21 for Wake Forest. Really started the season as a wide receiver. Actually started the first six games at wide receiver because of a bunch of injuries. It wasn't until November 4th he got his first start at running back against Boston College.
Well, and he's still their third leading receiver on this football team. They throw him the ball. He's got 30 receptions. He's going to be a factor in the passing game.
This is Kenneth Moore changing directions. And nobody fooled on the Louisville Cardinal defense. Malik Jackson snuffed it out early.
You know, you talk about Malik Jackson, number 11 for Louisville. This is a guy you talk so much about Louisville's offense, but Malik Jackson on defense has been phenomenal. Again, a misdirection play. Watch number 11 for Louisville just fighting off the block of the quarterback. Riley Skinner, often not hard to do, fighting off the quarterback's block. But Malik Jackson, 8 sacks. He had 14 tackles for loss, forced a couple fumbles, recovered a couple, blocked a kick. Malik Jackson's done everything for the Louisville defense this year.
So another third and long here. Third and 17. Moore the lone back with Skinner. Overthrown just out of reach, intended for Willie Idelet. And that'll bring on the punting unit for Wake. Zach Anderson, the guy that penetrated, gave Skinner trouble there.
Yeah, and again, Riley Skinner pretty solid in the pocket. Again, just trying to two-deep zone, trying to get the guy right down the middle, just a little bit of high because of the coverage by A. Brown, 43 the middle linebacker, forced him to throw it a little bit high.
And the other thing about Wake Forest, they generated some first downs.
Yep.
They ate up some clock, and they got some field position. So, you know, even though they didn't handle the ball with a lot of skill that first series, they did do some good things, and field position is going to be key.
Yeah, now comes the tough part.
Sam Swank with a big booming punt. Trent Guy calls for the fair catch. And at the 26-yard line is where the Louisville offense takes over for the first time tonight. We'll be right back. back from Miami is Brian Brahman. The Cardinals offense will go to work for the first time tonight. The four-time Big East Player of the Week, already fourth on the all-time passing list at Louisville, completing a fantastic junior year. A two tight end set for him as he pitches to George Stripling, who surges forward to the 30-yard line, a gain of five on the carry. John Abate making the tackle for Wade. Well, Bobby Petrino's offense, as we talked about at the open, guys, is among the hottest, the biggest, the scariest in the nation.
Yeah, and they've got wide receivers and a tight end. All three of those guys can get deep very quickly.
Credit Stripling with only 3 yards on that initial carry. That pass complete to Harry Douglas, who led the nation in receiving yards in November and December. Let's meet the rest of the Louisville offense up front. Even with the great skill position talent, Bobby Petrino calls this group the strength of his offense. Bussey, Quarterman, and Foster, all Big East first teamers. Backs and receivers, so much firepower here. Yerudy and Douglas, NFL-level talents. Colby Smith at tailback, one of three thoroughbreds that will rotate in and out there. We've already seen George Stripling in the backfield.
Yeah, those three guys combined for almost 1,600 yards in replacing Michael Bush, who was injured the first game.
They split Stripling out wide. And on first and 10, Brom looking downfield, flushed out on the move. He's not going to make anybody forget about Michael Vick, but he gets up to the 45-yard line. The Demon Deacons up front on defense. Giles Tucker voted by his teammates as Wake's best athlete. He's also their sack leader with six. The linebacking core, you saw John Abate, just the third player in ACC history to lead his team in tackles as a freshman, sophomore, and junior. And in the secondary, the Deeks lead the nation with 22 interceptions. Fifth-year senior safeties Gaddis and G have been outstanding all year long. Colby Smith in the backfield now on second and four. And the hand is to the Cardinals' leading rusher, who bounces off a tackle and is taken down at the 49 by Riley Swanson and John Russell.
One thing the Wake Forest defense is going to try to do is make Louisville one-dimensional. They're going to load up with a lot of eight-man fronts. They have really good safeties, and they're going to go ahead and try to get Brian Brohm to have to beat them. I know that sounds strange with an outstanding quarterback like that.
But you know what, Terry? He can. I mean, he can beat him with his right arm. I mean, I know every coach is able to stop the run, but Brian Brohm can beat you with his right arm and good decision-making.
Once again, the Cardinals split George Stripling out wide at the top of your screen, so a four-receiver set, empty backfield here for Brohm.
Harry Douglas is the guy I think is going to cause Wake some problems.
There he goes again, taken down at the 41-yard line after another 7-yard pickup. John Abate on the tackle.
Brian Brohm is surprisingly mobile. I mean, I saw this a couple weeks ago when they played against Connecticut earlier in the year. I mean, he's a big old guy, 6'4", almost 230 pounds.
Well, this is what Wake's defense has got to do. It's got to survive the shock and awe of the Louisville offense. You know, they're already across the 50. They're on the 41-yard line. Mm-hmm. You know, the quarterback's making some plays with his legs. They're able to run the ball. Wake's got to get them stopped and give up 3 points, and certainly not seven.
The shock and awe and all the personnel groupings as well, as that carry takes Cardinals down to the 39-yard line.
You know, Terry, just following up, I mean, this Louisville team in their 12 games scored on 50% of their opening drives. You know, six times they scored in their opening. Four of those were for touchdowns. So, you know, you really have to survive early against these guys and force them into a tight, close game. Most teams have not been able to do it.
No, Louisville loves to play fast. They love to establish a tempo. Yeah. And if you can somehow get them off their rhythm, that really helps you from a defensive standpoint. It's not an easy thing to do, but if you can break their rhythm a little bit, that's how you disrupt that kind of an offensive attack.
You're going to measure the first down. But Bobby Petrino is the head coach, but really calls the plays and unusually signals them in. I mean, most head coaches don't, but he'll call the plays. They get some input from his brother, Paul Petrino, who's ostensibly the offensive coordinator. But Bobby Petrino is a terrific play caller and very aggressive.
So Louisville converts. It's a first down from the Wake 38.
I was saying, I think this guy, Harry Douglas, is a guy today
who is, you know, Wake Forest has not seen the kind of speed that Harry Douglas can throw at you.
Douglas, the man in motion. Brom keeps it now looking downfield, down the middle of the field, and dropped by Urrutia. Hit him right in the hands.
Well, he looked a little bit like T.O. on that one.
Boy, it's a great play fake by Brian Braun. He really does a great job of hiding the ball from the defense. And Urrutia is wide open down the middle on the post route. It just, that hand got in there at the very end, maybe tipped the ball.
Yeah, Riley Swanson got in there late.
Anthony Allen has checked in for the first time tonight. A true freshman from Tampa. This is Allen. And the ball's loose. Allen tries to jump on it. A scrum at the 39. Wake says they've got it.
Well, that's the 15th fumble of the year that Louisville has lost. One negative offensive stat they've had. Terry, you talked about it.
Demon Deacon football. You know, it sounds cliche when you hear a coach saying we've got to force turnovers to win a game like this. So far, so good for the underdog Demon Deacons. Kevin Patterson jumped on the fumble, and Wake's offense will take over in good field position. Left in the first quarter, and Wake Forest, with its outstanding success at forcing turnovers, at plus 14, fourth best in the nation. They're at it again tonight as Aaron Curry knocked the ball free defensively, and that puts Riley Skinner back on the field to start things at the 39. Double tight end set. The hand is to Moore on the misdirection, good for a gain of a couple of yards. Here's one of the great looks from our DLP Ultimate Picture Camp. Great pictures shown to you tonight throughout the 73rd annual FedEx Orange Bowl.
The game has started quite well for Wake Forest, don't you think, Coach? Is the way they want it?
Yeah, I really do. I think, you know, they mishandled the ball in their opening drive a few times. They got fortunate. Louisville wasn't quite as fortunate losing the turnover. Wake was a little more fortunate early, but I think Wake Forest has got to be very pleased with only 6 minutes left in the first quarter. They've got the ball on the 42-yard line. That's a good thing for Wake Forest.
Skinner throwing on second and seven, and he's got Nate Morton again for a first down. Nate Morton, a guy that they didn't know they were going to have tonight necessarily. He hurt himself in practice with a dislocated finger. He was questionable just a couple of weeks ago.
Yeah, as a matter of fact, I don't think he was questionable. They said he wasn't going to play. Good pickup block by Kenny Moore. Good out route by Nate Morton. Kind of a versatile guy. He's, you know, caught touchdowns. He's thrown touchdowns. He's run for touchdowns. Like all these wide receivers at Wake Forest, they're asked to do a lot of things.
So on first and 10 from the 46. Another double tight end set. Kenneth Moore, the lone back to Skinner. Moving people with the play clock running. They get it off with 2 seconds to spare. This is Moore. Moore, another guy who at one point during the season was injured. And they were hopeful that they wouldn't be without him tonight. We've got a late flag after the tackle.
Bobby Petrino before the game wanted to get off to that very quick start.
There is no foul on the play. The slap today was a quick. There is no foul. Second down.
Tom Ritter looks amazed by his own non-call, didn't he? His eyes were bugging out on us there.
Terry, when is a slap to the head okay? A slap to the head. Okay.
All I heard was a slap to the head. That's usually a call.
Yeah, number 14, Rod Council. Oh. That's a funny. Yeah, was a friendly little, that wasn't a penalty. It was a friendly little tap, wasn't it?
Yeah, that was a sportsmanship.
Yeah, that was a friendly little tap. Good no call, I think.
So second and 8 now. Zach Selman, the tight end, resets. Kevin Marion, the man in motion. And on the reverse, boy, they snuffed that out quickly. Amobi Okoye there again. None of this is fooling the 19-year-old senior Amobi Okoye.
Look at Amobi Okoye. He plays defensive tackle, but you see how quick he is off the ball. It's his 34th solo stop. To me, it's really amazing that a guy who plays inside has that many solo stops.
The other thing that's interesting about him, Pat, is that you're looking at a 19-year-old college graduate.
Yeah, he's right in here.
He came to Louisville when he was 16 years old, and he's a team leader at 19, which is very unusual for a young guy like that to be the leader of that football team.
Yeah, as Bobby Petrino said, you know, not only is he 19 years old, he's one of the best leaders we've ever had at Louisville.
A guy that wasn't even shaving when he went to college. So after the big loss of 3rd and 18 now, the Dukes have already converted 3rd and long a couple of times tonight, but not here. Malik Jackson.
Yeah. 9th sack of the year for Malik Jackson. We talked about him a little bit earlier. This guy is so good off the corner. Now, the amazing thing is he plays really kind of the Sam linebacker, and yet he still makes all these negative plays. Sam linebacker generally plays over the tight end, yet he's able to fight through those kinds of guys and make those plays. 9th sack of the year, 15th tackle for a loss.
So Wake unable to do anything with the great field position. Sam Swank, who is the only player in the country that was a semifinalist for both the Luke Rosa and Ray Guy Awards, just got that one away. Trent Guy moving backwards as he fields the punt. Now trying to get lateral and dragged down by Josh Gattis at the 11-yard line. Brian Brahman, the offense, will give it another whack when we come back from Miami. Clemson University is a finalist for the Pontiac Game-Changing Performance of the Year. The Tigers have already won a $5,000 scholarship from Pontiac for this defensive score against Wake Forest. Vote now at Pontiac.com/NCAA to help decide the winner of the $100,000 Pontiac Game-Changing Performance of the Year, which will be announced at the Tostitos BCS National Championship game right here on Fox, January 8th.
I guess some of those games last night, the Fiesta Bowl don't count, right? The end of that game, whoa.
You know, I don't ever think we went off the air from that game transmission last night.
It cost me about 3 hours of sleep.
George Stripling in the backfield with Brahm here on 1st and 10 from the 11. The pass is to Stripling, trying to get away from a couple of tacklers and taken down at the line of scrimmage. John Abate nearly always around the football for Wake. All ACC, and he's a guy that defensive coordinator Dean Hood calls his NFL films guy. Beat up, bloody, always on the ball, but there's much more to this story, and for that we check in with Laura Oakman.
There's so much more, Matt. After John Abate's little brother, Luke, died in a car accident last February, John couldn't even get out of bed. He stopped going to classes, stopped going to football practice. His parents had to tag team, taking turns, going to Winston-Salem just to make sure he got out of bed. But he now honors his brother by living and playing football, changing his number, we all know, from 40 to 5.
Laura, thanks. It's one of those stories that goes from really a tough one to absorb to an uplifting story. The fact that John has been able to deal with the loss of his brother and is having such a fine junior year.
Well, they pay a tribute to him right at the beginning of the fourth quarter every game.
Not a whole lot of ground for Louisville. A couple of running plays, good for a total of 1 yard. Colby Smith is the lone back here.
Well, they have made him one-dimensional, Terry, just like you said.
I think that's what Wake Forest needs to do, make Brahm beat you.
Brahm looking downfield. He has a target, tried to get it to Gary Barnage, but in traffic, he was all wrapped up by Josh Gattis and company.
You know, I think we can go back to the fumble by Louisville. They had a great drive going. All of a sudden, they fumble the ball. Wake gets the ball, punts it, gets good field position, and now the Cardinals, 2 runs and a throw down the field. They don't have any room, so they don't get to really operate with the freedom that they're used to operating with.
And look who knocked the ball away, John Abate, right there in coverage.
Corey Getchy on to punt. Willie Idolette is the deep man for Wake, and he's standing right on the Wake 50. Oh, my goodness.
How did he miss that?
Almost swatted away, and it bounces out of bounds in unbelievable field position. Looked like
Alfonso Smith, I don't know how he missed blocking that thing cleanly.
He must have certainly done something because that, yeah, you know, that punt goes out of bounds in field goal range. What are the Demon Deacons thinking? Tonight's fantastic aerial looks are being brought to us by Budweiser Select. Oh, but you got to get a lot lower to take a look at what nearly happened on that punt.
Well, Alfonso Smith just ran right ball by the ball. Nonetheless, forced a bad punt. Wake Forest has great field position.
Well, and credit should go to Corey Getchie for getting that kick off.
Yeah, you're right.
As he did. Though the Deacs start the drive at the Louisville 28. The hand is to Rich Belton, the fullback carrying, and he's dropped after no gain.
Let's have another look at the near wrist. Right part of the screen, number two, in the black jersey, Alfonso Smith runs right by the ball. And we said, hey, special teams, Jim Grope said, special teams are going to win this game for us. A big opportunity for the double thud there. Just couldn't get it. He just ran right by it. I don't know how he missed it, Terry, actually.
Well, you know, Jim Grope said you couldn't practice special teams enough for a bowl game, and he just worked his team. You know, they mishandled, Wake mishandled the opening kickoff. It didn't really cost them, but this punt really did cost Louisville.
After a gain of two on the Belton carry, second and eight now. Play action, Skinner hanging on and running for dear life. Down he goes again. Abe Brown got to him here.
You got Abe Brown coming in. You also have a Moby, a Koye.
One of the things that the Wake Forest offensive line, they're going to have difficulty all night long with this Louisville defense. This defense is built for speed. They want to run. They don't want to slow down. And the thing that they're going to do is, the hardest thing that they have to do is try to keep leverage on the ball. And they have eliminated Wake Forest's ability to run sweeps and counterplays.
Last time there was a scoreless first quarter at the FedEx Orange Bowl, the game ended with 69 total points. We highlight Brady Quinn, a candidate for the singular All-American Player of the Year Award. The Notre Dame QB threw for over 3,200 yards and 35 touchdowns in leading the Irish to a 10-2 record and an appearance in tomorrow night's All-State Sugar Bowl. To vote for Brady Quinn or any of the other candidates, text 87654 on your singular wireless phone or go to foxsports.com, keyword singular, for more information. The start of the second quarter, Kenneth Moore, the ball carrier, and taken down at the 26 by Brandon Cox. And guys, we talked about this, getting out to the break. You don't see scoreless first quarters in the FedEx Orange Bowl very often. But the last time we saw one of these scoreless firsts, the game ended with a whole lot of points as Tom Brady's Michigan Wolverines put up 69 combined points with Alabama in 2000.
Yeah, Tom Brady keeps doing it too, doesn't he?
I tell you what, these two teams, I think, are just warming up. This is the calm before the storm.
You think you're going to get 69 points today?
No, no, I don't. I think it's going to be a low-scoring game, but I think they'll score some points.
Sam Swank would settle for three, and from 44 yards out, Swank is up and good. Jim Grove's Demons on the scoreboard first in Miami.
The FedEx Orange Bowl on Fox is presented by the Nissan Titan, proud sponsor of the BCS and tough guys everywhere.
Time now for the Nissan Sports Shift. Prior to 2006, Louisville and Wake Forest were better known as basketball schools, but this season they have enjoyed quite a shift.
They're playing back.
In terms of Louisville hoop, how about Wes Unseld, Dr. Duncanstein, Purvis Ellison of more recent vintage? And for Wake, we go back to Billy Packer, Little Muggsy Bogues. Tim Duncan put the program really on the map in the middle 90s. Maybe the most underrated player in the NBA today, Josh Howard, Chris Paul.
I think that Tim Duncan's going to make it. I really do.
Think he's going to have a future?
I think he's going to have a nice career.
But, you know, applications for admission spiked at Wake in the middle 90s when that basketball program was going gangbusters, and it's happened again with the football program as good as it's been this year. This is Juwan Spillman from the end zone, and tackled just outside the 15-yard line. Tomorrow night, the Tostitos Bowl Bash continues with the All-State Sugar Bowl as Notre Dame takes on LSU in a showdown between two of college football's greatest programs. Our coverage of the All-State Sugar Bowl begins tomorrow at 7:30 Eastern, 4:30 Pacific on High Def, only on Fox.
Well, Notre Dame, I think, is really going to have to survive that early onslaught by LSU. They outscored their opponents 122-20 in the first quarter.
LSU is a very physical team, very talented. Notre Dame's going to have their hands full, I think, in that bowl game. But they'll play well.
Oh, yeah.
But I think LSU will win that game. And they got a guy named Brady Quinn who's pretty good.
Handoff is to Colby Smith on the delay at past the 20, tackled at the 21-yard line.
You know, one of the things that's happening in this game, guys, is that Louisville's had such poor field position. And no matter how aggressive you are as a signal caller, you're not quite as aggressive when you're inside your own 20 as you are when you're outside your own 20. So Bobby Petrino, that's one of the difficulties he's had. He just hasn't had good field position to kind of open up his playbook.
Brock Bolin is the lone back for Louisville here on second and four. The toss is to Bolin. And forging forward to the 26-yard line before being tackled by you-know-who John Abadi.
You know, Brock Bolin is a guy that Bobby Petrino was saying, boy, wish we had given him a few more touches this year. Kind of plays their fullback, good lead blocker, good receiver. And you saw there a pretty good runner.
Yeah, and Bobby Petrino said every time we give him the ball or ask him to do something, he does it well. And so he's really high on Bolin as a player.
See a signal of the plays in there, Matt? I really don't see head coaches actually signaling plays in, but Bobby Petrino does it. Very up-tempo offense. The quarterbacks usually have, you know, 15, 16 seconds left to call an audible in and out of the huddle.
The freshman Anthony Allen has checked into the backfield now. And on first and 10, the hand is to Allen. Bouncing off a tackle and finally taken down after the 30 by Kevin Patterson.
How about Anthony Allen, the freshman from Tampa Jesuit High School there? You know, did just about everything. Played some quarterback there, was on the track team where he ran the 100 meters, the long jump, high jump, triple jump. What was he, a black belt in karate, they told us. And I tell you, they are really high in this. He said he is as physical a runner as Michael Bush was. And he's just a freshman.
Yeah, and Bobby Petrino said that he's the best athlete on the team. If you're just judging athletes, you think of the athletes spread out on this Louisville team. And that guy's the best athlete of them all.
Passing on third and short, and that one's batted away. Jeremy Thompson from the right end got the big meat hook up in the air and swatted it down.
You know, yeah, Jeremy Thompson is a guy that, you know, doesn't flash much, doesn't make a lot of necessary plays you notice, but the coaches always say when you watch the tape the next day, Jeremy Thompson shows up.
So on third and short now, the nickel package on the field for Wade.
Third about six.
Third and six, not so short at all. And Brom looking down center field, he's got an open target. The catch is made at the 46-yard line. Harry Douglas, the all Big East wideout on the reception.
Okay, this is the guy that Bobby Petrino was saying, hey, I don't think that Wake Forest has seen the kind of speed that Harry Douglas has. Deep in, which means he's getting really good protection. And, you know, as a quarterback, what you appreciate about that route, he didn't drift off into center field, came right down the line, snagged the ball with his hands, didn't bobble it, picked up a first down.
This is the kind of offense that folks certainly watching back in Kentucky are used to moving down the field. Off play action now. Brom lets it drive. Yerudia out of bounds at the 36.
Terry, great protection for Brian Brom. You know, we talk about all these athletes outside and the tight end and such, but three all Big East offensive linemen. Look at the time that Brian Brom has to throw in that big throwing lane.
Well, and Yerudia runs a really nice out route, just hangs there on the sideline. The ball is put in a perfect position. It's a great throw, really, by Brian Brom.
Timeout on the field with Louisville on the march. 11:31 left in the half. 3-0 Demon Deacons.
After, for the review, video evidence confirmed the ruling on the
field. Was a catch. First down.
Yeah, the official time was taken upstairs. They wanted to take a look at this Urrutia reception again to make sure a foot was in bounds and that he wasn't juggling the ball when that happened. And, of course, instant replay rules at the collegiate level. All plays are subject to officials' review upstairs. Each coach is allowed one challenge given they have timeouts left. And if the challenge is not upheld, that timeout is lost. So after the first down reception, here's Brom rolling. Looking for some place to throw it to, and he's finally taken out of bounds at the 35.
What a nice block by Kurt Quarterman on the blitzing John Abadi. John Abadi coming full steam after Brian Brom, and Quarterman, the right guard, number 76, kind of picks him up. Good blitzer is Abadi. A lot of that is timing. Watch number 76 kind of peel back and pick him off. At least gave Brian Brom in there, right there. Brian Brom gave him a chance. You know, Kurt Quarterman, all one of those three all Big East offensive linemen for Louisville.
Second and nine, Brom out of the shotgun.
Oh,
he threw that one high and laid his receiver into trouble. Kevin Patterson was there to apply the nasty hit.
You never want to throw late into the flat or high into the flat. Exactly right, huh, Pat Hayden?
Particularly if you're the mother of the receiver that's being late thrown to.
Don't hang those guys out there. Kevin Patterson, number 10, is just lurking out there. You can hear the impact of that kind of a collision. The ball gets knocked loose. It could have been a big turnover against Louisville had the receiver maintained possession.
Third and nine, they hand off, and the explosive sophomore corner, Alfonso Smith, was there to trip up Colby Smith.
Two big plays by Alfonso Smith for Wake Forest in this first half. One, the partially blocked punt, and here on a third and long, kind of trying to hit a quick draw, a blitz off the corner. This is a guy, probably their best cover guy, who had a great freshman year, was benched, though, early this year, but he came back and has played better the last 4 or 5 weeks.
Louisville keeps the offensive unit on the field on fourth and nine. They are 7 of 10 in fourth down conversions this year.
Terry, that's 70% for you.
I'll tell you what, this is a good call, I think, by Louisville to go for this.
Brom has Gary Barnage and a Louisville first down.
When we talk about all three of these wide receivers being big play guys, Gary Barnage, the tight end, has averaged 17 yards a catch. That his 30th catch of the year. The lumbering big old tight end, number 82. Really, really kind of a wide receiver type.
And you're talking about a big receiver. You're talking about 6'6 tight end, and then you go over to number 7, Urrutia. Yeah. That guy's 6'6. So you've got big targets for Louisville. That's why they're the offensive team that they are.
The pitches to Anthony Allen, looking for some running room around the left side and taken down at the 20-yard line.
You know, one of the reasons they score 40 points a game is these wide receivers and tight ends who get up the field and are able to make a lot of big plays and good after the catch as well. Big averages per catch by the two wide receivers and the tight end. That perhaps the most dangerous guy. Look at Harry Duggan, over 18 yards. Urrutia 17, and the tight end, Gary Barnage, over 17.
Douglas is so smooth. He glides when he comes out of his breaks. A very gifted, quick athlete.
Second and five now. It's Anthony Allen again, picking his way up the line and tackled after a gain of two.
You know, one thing that's apparent, Wake Forest is better against the run defense than certainly I anticipated. I thought with that huge offensive line, Pat, you've mentioned three of those guys are all Big East. The center, Eric Woods, he's second team all Big East. I mean, they've got really a good offensive line. Right now, they're not really able to knock Wake off the ball. So, as they anticipated, Brian Brom is having to win this game and move the ball for him.
A fourth receiver, Trent Guy, has checked in for the Cardinals, and a flag.
They stuffed that thing way down there.
Dead ball. False start. Number 63 on the offense. 5-yard penalty. Main third down.
They get the left guard, Danny Barlow, the first penalty of the game. Boy, the Cardinals are so good in the red zone. They're so good up and down the field. We talked about the total offense, second in the nation. tied for the third best scoring offense in the country. They can throw it, they can run, all kinds of weapons.
Well, you know, the really good teams have a couple of different ways they can beat you. The Cardinals this year have been able to do that to most teams.
Brom can't find a target and finally has to spike it in front of his intended receiver, Mario Yerudia. This is not supposed to be the way this game went down, guys. If you were going to find a weakness on the Demon Deacons' defense, it's their pass defense. You know, they were stout against the run this year, 72nd in the nation versus the pass, but they're giving Brom all kinds of trouble in that he hasn't had a lot of open targets tonight.
Well, a couple things. You know, they put pressure, a lot of pressure on the quarterback this year. They did come in with 30 sacks and have had 22 interceptions this season.
Art Carmody is 10 of 10 from 40 or more. This one from 41, and good to tie us at 3. Count that as a big win for the Demon Deacons. A low scorer in Miami tonight. A 3-3 tie with 8:30 left in the half. Back alongside Terry Donahue and Pat Hayden, Matt Bashkirjian, not the big scorer that we were thinking we might see right out of the chute. After all, you know, Bobby Petrino's Louisville Cardinals had scored on their opening drive in 6 of 12 games, but they've been shut down tonight so far.
Well, Terry thought it was a high-scoring game. I thought it was going to be 3-3 right about this point, actually. Remember that, Terry?
Listen, Jim Grobe and Wake Forest love this game right now. They're loving it.
Kick will bounce into the end zone as Kevin Marion lets it roll. Wake will take over at the 20-yard line. Monday, it's the game that college football has been waiting for as Chris Leak and the Florida Gators take on Heisman Trophy winner Troy Smith and the Ohio State Buckeyes in the first ever Tostitos BCS National Championship game. Our coverage begins Monday at 7:30 Eastern, 4:30 Pacific in high def only on Fox.
Look, Troy Smith won the Heisman Trophy, Chris Leak, and don't forget Tim Tebow plays a lot for Florida as well. I just don't think they can stay with Ohio State. I think they've got too much offensive firepower.
Yeah, I think Troy Smith will be the difference in that game. Leak is a very fine player, but I don't know if he's...
One player on the offense, five-yard penalty, main first down.
I don't know if he's going to be as productive as Smith will be.
Substitution penalty, too many men. Good look at Jim Grobe. What a job Jim Grobe has done this year. Player of the year, coach of the year, but named by the Sporting News recently.
First ever conference championship for Wake since 1970. Back-to-back 4-7 seasons. Picked to finish last by many of the alleged experts. This is Kenneth Moore on the reception in the flat.
You know, Jim Grobe is a guy with a plan. You know, came in 6 years ago, and he has a very patient administration and athletic director, Terry, and I think that was key. How many coaches, you know, in today's high-stakes football could go 24-32 in their first 5 years and survive their sixth year to turn it around and go 11-2?
Yeah, and I think his plan is to redshirt everybody that comes into the program, which really helps him with his experience, and he's got a lot of coaches who've worked for him for a long time.
Not a sweep, but back up the middle is Kenneth Moore. Nate Harris makes the tackle after a gain of a couple of yards. Another look at our great DLP Ultimate Picture Cam. These pictures coming to you throughout our coverage of the 73rd annual FedEx Orange Bowl tonight.
You know, going back to Jim Grobe, he talked about his staff that's been with him 12, 14 years, and he said that it's really helped him kind of relax and take some pressure off himself and to have a more balanced life. He spends more time with his family, his wife, because he has such confidence that his coaches are getting it done for him.
Takes a walk with his wife every day at noon, even during the season.
Third and 10. Skinner flushed out, lets it fly, incomplete.
A good defensive series for Louisville. Very good defensive series when they needed it. We're going to get good field position after this punt by Wake Forest. And then Brian Brom has got to get hot.
A couple things about Louisville's defense. One, they've totally shut down Wake's running game. Right now, Wake has minus 20 yards rushing. And number two, they've kept great leverage on the ball, so all the misdirections and the reverses have dried up on Wake Forest. That's a real problem going forward.
Short kick by Sam Swank as Juwan Spillman returns and goes to his knee at the 46-yard line. Just a 27-yard punt and good field position for the Cardinals when we come back.
The FedEx Orange Bowl on Fox is sponsored by Singular, raising the bar, by Taco Bell, official fan of college bowl action, and by DLP, HDTV powered by DLP. It's amazing. It's the mirrors.
Well, in our meetings with Bobby Petrino, he was every bit aware as to how good the pass defense of the Demon Deacons could be. Leading the nation in interceptions. They've held opponents to 14 points or less in 8 of 13 games. They've been very stout here tonight. This is Colby Smith up ahead to the 40-yard line. Louisville starts the possession, however, in great field position after the gain of 7.
And that's what you like on first down. When you call a solid running play like that, you generate 6-7 yards. Now it's easy to call offense on second down. That's when the signal caller can be loose and do the things he wants to do.
A gain of 6 by Smith on that first down carry. Brown has not had a lot of open targets tonight. There's one. Harry Douglas with yards after the catch and finally dragged out of bounds by Patrick G. That's that Steve Smith skill set that Harry Douglas brings to the Cardinals. A lot of yards after the catch.
Yeah, I think they're going to run him at Churchill Downs the first weekend of May. This, you know, he's got incredible speed, this Harry Douglas. Remember, Bobby Petrino was saying he's so good after the catch, no waste. As soon as he caught that ball, he turned and picked up one, another 12 yards.
And I think Kevin Patterson and Riley Swanson and Alfonso Smith, the three corners for Wake, they've played well early, but They're going to have their hands full as this game keeps unfolding. There's so much speed on the field for Louisville.
And you're rooting it down here at the bottom of the screen. They haven't used any double moves yet.
They swing it out to Patrick Carter, looking to throw the football. He's got a wide open receiver. Touchdown, Cardinals! Anthony Allen out of the backfield. A 21-yard touchdown strike from the wideout to the tailback. Carmody PAT is good. What were you saying earlier, Coach Donahue, about shock and awe?
Well, you know, I really expected the trick plays to come from Wake Forest, not from Louisville. And Louisville laid one on them there with the throwback to the tailback.
Well, the touchdown toss to Anthony Allen, and we were talking about it before the break. It's the gadget play, and it works to perfection here for Louisville.
I'll tell you, Patrick Carter, his first completion in his career through a pass last year, but a timely one at that. And Anthony Allen, you know, as Coach said to us yesterday, he likes the end zone. He's got a nose for the end zone, but it starts at about the 30-yard line.
This is a guy that scored 12 rushing TDs, speaking of Allen, on only 89 carries. That's the fewest carries per TD in Division 1A. He catches one here in the FedEx Orange Bowl, and it puts Louisville on top by a touchdown. Todd Flannery to kick it away. This is Kevin Marion on the return. And tripped up at the 21-yard line.
You know, going back to that touchdown, Bobby Petrino, I think you've got to give him credit. He calls plays to get the ball to athletes. He doesn't call plays off a list because he likes plays. He wants certain athletes to get the ball, and certainly in that case, he told us Anthony Allen is my best athlete. So what you do as a coach, you want to make sure the best athletes touch that ball.
Two pretty good athletes, Patrick Carter throwing it and Anthony Allen catching it. important series here right now for Wake Forest, man. You know, they can't let this game get out of hand with about 5 minutes left in the first half.
Here comes the blitz. It gets picked up as Skinner's pass on first down is caught at the 30-yard line by Willie Idelet.
Good opening play by Riley Skinner. You know, both these quarterbacks, sons of quarterbacks. Riley Skinner's father played quarterback at Georgia Tech. Brian Brohm's father played quarterback at Louisville. And, you know, as we watch Riley Skinner, Steve Lobotsky, the offensive coordinator, was saying to us earlier this week, he said, I've never seen a guy throw it more accurately than Riley Skinner.
Second and a yard. The hand is to Kenneth Moore, a first down and more as he's tackled at the 37 by Abe Brown.
Pat, I think you're 100% right. It's important that Wake's able to generate some first downs and some yardage. Right now they've got about 42 total yards.
Yeah, but sooner or later they've got to get the ball in the end zone too, Terry, don't you think? I mean, it's just one of those things. They've kept it close, but they're going to have to get a payoff when they get down, when they cross the 50.
No question. But first downs generates points.
The opportunities.
You get 26 first downs, 30 first downs in a game, you're going to generate points.
That was Wake's second first down since the opening drive. And a couple of them on their first set of possessions. And this is Kenneth Moore, who's bruised shy of the 40-yard line by Amobi Okoye and company.
Louisville's defensive football team is so fast, and they're physical up front. They can run to the ball, and they've done a great job preparing for this game in terms of keeping leverage on the football. You know, Wake has tried to sweep the corners with their favorite plays, tried to get misdirection going. They've been unable to do that, and it's because Louisville has played those plays very, very well.
I wonder what leverage meant. That's good. Now I know.
That means keep the ball inside you, baby.
I was an offensive player. I didn't worry about defense too much.
Second and six now. Once again, nobody fooled on that defensive line. Adrian Gray penetrated from tackle and drops Moore for a 5-yard loss.
But Adrian Gray, he actually started the season as a starter, was injured, and then he has really responded the last three or four games. Adrian Grady, truly explosive off the ball.
You know, when you watch this game, and especially on some of these running plays, it might remind some Wake fans of the Virginia Tech game, and those aren't good memories for them, because Virginia Tech was not fooled at all by any of the misdirection. They were there to really snuff out the Demon Deacons running game.
Well, no, Louisville's had a month to get ready for this, not three or four days.
Skinner out of the shotgun, and there's one of his favorite targets, John Tereshinsky. We say that with a little bit of irony, as Tereshinsky has not caught a lot of passes this year. His brother Joe stars at Georgia. In fact, Tereshinsky comes from a long line of Georgia football players. He was the only turncoat among them.
Look at the passer efficiency rating of Riley Skinner this year. And we start, he said, he started as a 13th quarterback. Matter of fact, when they finally sent him in the game after the starting quarterback got injured, he could not find his helmet. He had to call timeout.
13-yard gain on the completion to the tight end. Here's Skinner out of the shotgun again. Another open target. That one complete to Kevin Marion for another Wake Forest first down. Well, Riley Skinner is, in fact, the ACC Freshman of the Year, 10-2 as a starter. We've already talked about how accurate he is, the ACC's leader in completion percentage, third among NCAA freshmen in interception percentage, only one every 57 attempts, and in passing efficiency. This guy wasn't even in the plans earlier this year.
He was holding the clipboard when the season started.
This is Marion, one of the burners from wideout. Marion still going. Another Wake Forest first down.
I tell you, Rod Council, number 14 for Louisville, doesn't get a hand on him. I think he goes all the way to the end zone.
Well, Kevin Marion's one of those guys with legitimate speed for Wake Forest. You're talking about a guy that runs on the 4x100 relay team. He's got the speed to really stress the Louisville defense. This is the first counter play that's really been effective tonight. They finally found a little crease in that defense. He broke a tackle, was able to generate a nice game for Wake Forest.
53 yards on the drive so far. The carry here is by Rich Belton. Tackle just shy of another Demon Deacon first down. They do have some burners on offense, and those two wideouts, you talked about Kevin Marion and Willie Idolette, teammates on Wake Forest's ACC champion 4x100 relay team. And that was a team that set a school record in the event. Idolette also ran on the 4x400 team.
Wake Forest has picked up the tempo a little bit. They're stressing Louisville's defense. They're getting the play called. Skinner's doing a nice job checking off, controlling, and managing the game.
Inside the red zone. And a misdirection play again. Kenneth Moore follows the football. Louisville recovers. Malik Jackson.
You know, Malik Jackson again around the ball. His third fumble recovery of the year. He's already had a sack today, right? A tackle for a loss as well.
Adrian Grady made the hit to pop the ball loose, and Jackson was there to grab it for Louisville.
Boy, Jim Grobe's worst nightmare. Take care of the football. I tell you, they ought to replay that.
Yeah, his knee to look down.
I think he's down. I think they need to get a replay. I'd throw the flag if I was Jim Grobe.
Well, your coach has a challenge, but they do replay every play. It looked like his right knee was down.
They're going to take another look at this indeed as time is taken on the field.
That should not be a fumble.
We will get another look.
And this was a very impressive drive by Wake Forest. Their tempo was good. They found some holes. They were moving the football. Skinner hit some passes. They were loosening up that Louisville defense.
And remember, the call on the field was a fumble, so that's where a preponderance of the of evidence to say it did not. I think he's down, Terry.
I do too, Pat. I think the ball comes loose after his knee's down. I think they're going to overturn this call. That's got to be irrefutable evidence. And you're an attorney. Yep. I'm not sure exactly what that word means.
Well, that's close to being irrefutable. I didn't know what leverage meant.
Oh,
yes,
that knee is
knees
down.
He still has possession, right?
I think so. I think that's an easy call.
Well, we've got an all-star SEC crew here today.
In terms of turnover differential, the Demon Deacons at plus 14, as we already discussed, fourth best in the nation. It's a zero. Back to even for Louisville, and that ranks them 60th in the country. They've had problems hanging on to the football.
But you know, tonight, Matt, actually Wake Forest has had some trouble hanging on to that football.
No doubt.
I mean, if you look back and reflect back on the first quarter and the things that have happened so far in this first half, Wake Forest has not handled the ball with the skill that they traditionally have handled.
And it started on their opening possession.
Yeah, nice tackle by Riley Skinner. Remember, remind me of Ben Roethlisberger up against, was it Indianapolis last year in the playoffs?
Oh, that conference championship game, right.
Well, if Riley Skinner doesn't get a hand on Malik Jackson, he goes the distance.
Jim Grobe asks his quarterback to do a lot of things.
Yeah.
Throwing blocks, making tackles.
Yeah.
But, you know, you think about Wake Forest winning 11 games with your third-string quarterback.
Coaching, right?
You know, you lose your first string quarterback in the first game, and all of a sudden, you know, your second team guy goes down. You're playing with your third string quarterback. As a football coach, I can tell you, you don't expect to go 11-2.
Well, they lost their starting running back as well.
A reminder coming up on the Blockbuster Total Access Halftime Show, Chris Rose, Jimmy Johnson, and Dave Wanstead will break down the first half, plus American Idol Taylor Hicks brings the soul patrol to South Florida with a special halftime performance.
Terry loves Taylor Hicks.
He was talking about that coming over to the stadium today.
Listen, I'm a big fan of Gladys Knight's, too, boys. Yeah, I'm.
Name five of your favorite songs.
I'll tell you, Midnight Train to Georgia,
that's
number one hit. That was number one, baby.
That's good enough.
And I pulled it right out of the sky.
That's good. Seven-time Grammy winner.
Getting one last good definitive replay as to whether or not this was a fumble when Grady came in and stripped the ball away from Kenneth Moore.
Still haven't changed my opinion.
They're taking their time with this one upstairs. For obvious reasons.
It was a called a fumble on the field.
Well, you know, they are taking a lot of time, and I guess that word irrefutable is the key thing.
Did I explain it to you well enough? I'll let you know what it means.
Well, it means something like leverage. Is that what you said?
Well, at stake here is a drive that had taken Wake Forest inside the red zone, where they have been very efficient this year.
After further review, video evidence confirms a call on the field of the fumble. First down.
kick.
Wow.
Well, we were wrong, but what a huge turnover for the Louisville defense. It looked different to us up here on the replay, but the guys in the replay booth certainly have more angles and have great looks at it.
Yeah, I think they have the same ones we do, but they saw it just differently than we did. But so I go back and say Riley Skinner made a heck of a touchdown-saving tackle.
Boy, that's going to be a tough pill to swallow for Jim Grobe when he looks at this one tonight. So with a minute 42 left, Brown to work. And that one batted away. Boy, Alphonso Smith has been all over the field as he got in the way of Harry Douglas that time.
Well, Alphonso Smith's, you know, had a couple interceptions against Maryland. Came into the game with a 3 sacks and 3 interceptions. Alphonso Smith, number 2, nearly blocked a punt earlier in this game. Their best cover corner is Alphonso Smith.
You know, Pat, sometimes guys play better coming off the bench.
Yeah.
You know, and this is a guy, I think, Alphonso Smith, he does play better, at least at this stage of his career. He plays better off the bench than he does as a starter.
Well, he's right there. He's played awfully well this first half.
Second and 10 for Brown now. He's got Yerudi at the 35-yard line. And tackled at the 37 by John Abadi and Josh Gaddis.
This is a good tackling Wake Forest team too, Terry. You know, one thing is playing good coverage and all that, but there's not a lot of yards after the catch by Louisville today.
No, and that's been one of the key things
Louisville,
that they felt.
That is their first charge timeout in this half.
One of the key things coming into this game, Wake Forest talked about, we've got to make sure we eliminate or limit the yards after catch. They've done a very nice job of that. You know, it's interesting to watch Louisville here, a minute and 24 seconds on the clock. It's not like they're going into some kind of a slowed down offense.
Yes.
You know,
oh,
I mean,
they don't have slowed down.
I mean, they're still aggressive. Bobby's over there, you know, talking to his football team. I don't think he's going to sit on this lead. I think he's just going to play like it's nothing, and he wants to get the ball in the end zone.
Yeah, I don't think the Louisville offense is capable of sitting on a lead. There's just too much talent, too much firepower to expose.
Yeah, their basketball team, they have a four-corner offense, but their football team does not. He looks like he could be friends for Bill Moyers, doesn't he?
You know, you really couldn't contrast these two guys anymore. I mean, Coach Petrino is very buttoned down. He likes to control access. He likes to know what's going on with his football team. Jim Grobe holds open practices to fans and media. And you think for a coach that runs an offense as seemingly complicated and gadget-driven as Wake Forest's, he might want to close that down. Let's check in with Laura Oakman.
Matt, not only does Jim Grobe hold open practices for media, but that's for the public. I was at one of those last week in Winston-Salem, and let me tell you, he walked up to every single fan that was there, shook their hand, introduced himself, and thanked them for coming to practice. How's that?
Well, how's this? Laura, thanks. Brahm is stuffed on 3rd and 3. Once again, it's been a familiar theme, nowhere to throw it. Brian Andrews came in to make the tackle.
You are right, Matt. And there was terrific coverage downfield. Absolutely nowhere for Brian Brahm to throw this ball. Steps up, and then the sack by Brian Andrews.
Another timeout on the field. Wake spends a timeout. And once again, a reminder that tonight's beautiful aerial views are being brought to you by Budweiser Select.
Oh, yeah. Well, you know, Terry, you have to stay up past 8:30 to really enjoy this in South Beach here.
Oh, hey.
Don't you think, man?
I've got two Trojans up here in the booth with me now. At halftime, I'm going to have to talk to both you guys.
Minute 5 left in the half. And another reminder to stay with us at halftime. Our blockbuster Total Access halftime show, Chris, Jimmy, and Dave Wanstead will break down the first half in this one.
Yeah, Dave Wanstead was talking to us this morning. He had to try to slow down this Louisville team, head coach of Pittsburgh.
Yeah, Dave Wanstead was pretty candid when he told us he very much hopes that Brian Brahm decides to go to the NFL after this year.
Yeah.
He's not alone in that view, by the way.
Every head coach in the conference.
Yeah, they all feel like that, but it'll be interesting to see. I think, you know, Wake's going to get this ball with about a minute left to go in the half, and it's going to be interesting to see how they play offense now.
Boy, another one nearly blocked. Willie Idelette takes the line drive punt. Again, moving backwards, trying to get around a corner and runs out at the 35-yard line. No return after a 34-yard punt. Ryan McManus, the guy that shoved him out of bounds, as we remind you, tomorrow night, more great Tostitos BCS Bowl Bash action. The All-State Sugar Bowl, the Notre Dame Fighting Irish, and the LSU Tigers in a showdown of two of college football's biggest powerhouses. Coverage of the All-State Sugar Bowl starts tomorrow at 7:30 Eastern, 4:30 Pacific in high def on Fox. Kenny Albert, Howie Long, Jerry Bradshaw with the call tomorrow as Riley Skinner is dropped at the 32-yard line.
Hey, one guy is happy to see Howie Long do that game. Chris Fromm, the defensive end for Notre Dame, grew up in Southern California, watched Howie play for a long, long time, wears number 75 in honor of his favorite players, had a pretty good year for the Irish as well.
Take a look at the Demon Deacons and their possessions breakdown. Clock ticking. Wake has two timeouts left. Skinner looking downfield. And gets it complete past midfield to Kevin Marion.
Tell you, the thing about Riley Skinner, watch how his eyes are always downfield. It is so hard in there when there's an internal clock saying you've got to get rid of this ball. He didn't run. He didn't panic. Nice catch there by Kevin Marion.
Really nice job by Kevin Marion just hanging on the sideline. Yeah. Again, being a great outlet receiver for Riley Skinner. And Skinner, remember the last drive Wake had before the fumble. He hit some balls. He's getting hot.
Skinner keeps his cool, dumps it off across the 40-yard line to Nate Morton where he gets out of bounds. Again, two timeouts left, and they're going to need a little bit of additional yardage to get it into Sam Swank territory.
You know, we talk a lot about Idolette and Marion, their speed, but watching Wake Forest practice, Nate Morton was the guy that jumped out at me. I just thought he was a big physical receiver, great hands. He's got some running ability. I really like him as a player. He's a leading receiver.
D'Angelo Bryant in the backfield with Skinner. Again, another dump off. Willie Idolette out of bounds at the 30-yard line. So 6 seconds left on the halftime clock. William Gay, the man that ran them out of bounds. Bear in mind that Sam Swank has kicked 6 of the 10 longest field goals in Wake Forest history.
They have 5 of 7 from beyond 50 yards this year. As a matter of fact, at North Carolina State, he had 3 field goals over 50 yards.
His longest this year from 53. This is a 47-yard kick.
Timeout. Louisville, that is their second charge timeout of this half.
Still a little bucket of ice left for Bobby Petrino to try to get to Sam Swank. We again remind you to stay with us at halftime for our Blockbuster Total Access Halftime Show. In addition to breaking down the first half of the FedEx Orange Bowl, a preview of the All-State Sugar Bowl coming up tomorrow night from New Orleans. Let's once again check in with Laura Oakman.
Bobby Petrino has another thing coming if he thinks this is going to ice this kicker. Sam Swank, not only is he cool as it comes on the field, he was a lifeguard for a couple of summers. He estimates he took 5 people out of the water, including, you guys, a pregnant woman who was having seizures. Do you think this worries him seriously?
I count as 1 or 2, Laura.
Well, I'm not sure it worries him. I do think it's good to let the kicker think about it a little bit. You know, I do. I think in most cases, not in all cases, but certainly this guy is such a talented kicker. I think Louisville wants to talk about what block they're going to put on him and exactly where they expect to try and block this kick from.
John Temple, the holder. Again, Swank's long this year, 53. This from 47 yards away. No good. As the final seconds will tick away here in the first half. The lowest scoring first half of the FedEx Orange Bowl since 2001 when Oklahoma led Florida State 6-0 at halftime. Stay with us. The Blockbuster Total Access Halftime Show is coming up next.
Welcome to the Blockbuster Total Access Halftime Show on Fox.
right. Who would have thought that the one first half touchdown pass from a Louisville Cardinal would have come not from Carter to Anthony Allen. It's the lone touchdown of the 73rd FedEx Orange Bowl. Louisville, a 10-3 lead. It is day two of the Tostitos BCS Bowl Bash here on Fox. Welcome to the Blockbuster Total Access Halftime Show. Chris Rose once again rejoined by Dave Wonstadt and Jimmy Johnson. Jimmy, your impressions of the first half?
Chris, we talked about it in the pregame show. Wake Forest plays their best defense against their top opponents, their four ranked opponents that they played this year. Held them an average under 16 points. They're doing the same thing against Louisville. Outstanding defense. The only thing is Wake Forest has got to get their points from the special teams. They had two great rushes on the punt, got 3 points out of it, but they missed two scoring opportunities late in the second quarter.
Yeah, and when you look at the other side with Louisville, they came out early pressuring. They were hungry. They wanted to make this a quick game. They start pressuring with five or six. Now they've gone back. I think they got confidence that they can stop Wake Forest with their four front guys. The thing that Louisville has not done, like Jimmy said, they haven't come up with any big plays.
Yeah, in the meantime, Wake Forest has had eight negative plays. Let's show you the highlights really quickly from the first half. And it wasn't a real pretty first half for Wake Forest Demon Deacons. We showed it to you. A little trickery, kind of Boise State-ish, if you will. Patrick Carter winding up and throwing it all the way across the field to the freshman Anthony Allen. Now, Wake Forest did put a nice drive going. They got inside the red zone, but Kenneth Moore, a little oopsies. Remember, they were plus 14 in the turnover category this year. If you look, was his knee down? The refs took a look at it, a booth review, and they said no. They didn't get any points out of that. They missed a Sam Swank field goal right at the end of the half. They are down 10-3 at the break. All right, gentlemen, look into your crystal ball right now. What's going to happen in the second half, Jimmy?
Yeah, I really see Louisville starting to take the ball down the field. I think they'll be able to protect Brohm. He'll be able to throw the ball down the field. I see Louisville pulling away here in the second half.
I think that Wake Forest has to find a way to get the quarterback running the ball a little bit more. You know, they don't have a 1,000-yard rusher as a running back. I mean, they've kind of been running back by committee.
Right.
They're running a little read option. I think the quarterback's got to become more of a threat running the football to give him a chance to make some first downs.
Well, guys, of course, after tonight, the Tostitos BCS Bowl Bash will be only halfway over. Tomorrow night, we jet off to New Orleans in the All-State Sugar Bowl with a preview of Notre Dame and LSU. Here's Kenny Albert, Terry Bradshaw, and Howie Long.
Thanks, Chris. Here in New Orleans, we are less than 24 hours away from the 73rd All-State Sugar Bowl between fourth-ranked LSU and number 11 Notre Dame. Earlier today, pep rallies, bands, cheerleaders, fans from both schools enjoying the scenery in New Orleans. We welcome you to the field at the Louisiana Superdome. LSU taking their team photo just behind us. Kenny Albert along with Howie Long and Terry Bradshaw. And Terry, let's start with Notre Dame senior quarterback Brady Quinn. 35 touchdown passes this season. Getting ready to put the exclamation point on his outstanding collegiate career.
Well, he's fortunate today. He gets John Carlson back at tight end, a guy that can get down the middle fast. He's got great receivers, good running game, and I think our fans are going to enjoy the fact this kid can throw every pass, and he's very athletic. He can move.
And Howie, on the other side, Jamarcus Russell, LSU's junior quarterback, getting ready to make his first bowl start tomorrow.
Yeah, we have arguably the number one and two rated quarterbacks in the draft. 6'6", 256, depending upon what he ate today. He's a guy that outweighs the average linebacker from Notre Dame by 40 pounds, and he's as big as their defensive ends. Bo Davis and Doucette, very physical, very gifted wide receiving core. I think we could see a real fireworks display here on both sides of the ball.
Well, the teams are ready. We are ready. It's the 73rd All-State Sugar Bowl from New Orleans tomorrow night as we send it back to you guys in Miami.
All right, Kenny, thank you very much. I'm not so sure I want to let Terry, Howie, and Jimmy loose together in New Orleans, but that's what we're dealt with. Anyway, can you believe Notre Dame has dropped eight straight bowl games? They haven't won one since New Year's Day in 94.
Well, I think it's going to be difficult for them to change it tomorrow night. We still got lots of great football right here, but I'm looking forward to this game tomorrow night. Brady Quinn, I want to see him play. And then talking to the scouts, the pro scouts, they said the LSU team may be as talented a team as there is in the country.
Yeah, and I'm not counting Notre Dame on. I think they feel like they've been slighted all year, whether it's true or not. They've got a lot to prove, and I think everybody's hyping LSU up so much that it really presents a great opportunity for Notre Dame.
One other quick note. Last night we told you that Miami Dolphins head coach Nick Saban had until tonight to decide whether or not he would actually stay with the Miami Dolphins or take the University of Alabama job. He has a press conference tomorrow morning at 10 a.m. to give everybody that announcement. When we come back at the 73rd annual FedEx Orange Bowl, it's going to be Taylor Hicks and Gladys Knight performing. Don't miss it. It's next.
Fox Crew travels to the BCS Bowl Games, powered by NetJets, with their marquee jet card.
Welcome back. We're at halftime at the FedEx Orange Bowl in Miami with Louisville on top of Wake Forest, 10-3. You've got to consider that first half for the Demon Deacons a win. Their pass defense in particular in the first half, Pat, was outstanding.
Well, remember, Louisville is a team that averages almost 300 yards passing per game, but they have really been shut down. It's literally been a combination, I think, Matt, of good coverage. You see terrific coverage here and a good tackling, and then you combine that with a pass rush. Brian Brohm has just not had much of an opportunity to find anything downfield, and that has been the biggest surprise of the first half for me.
Well, Coach, they've got to get into the end zone at some point, though, Wake. Even though their defense has been stout, offensively they've been challenged tonight.
Yeah, you know, Wake's not been able to run the ball at all. And, you know, I know they don't want Riley Skinner to have to win the game, but he's hit 10 of 13 passes. He's kind of hot, and if they're going to win this game, I think Wake Forest has to start throwing the ball because they just can't run the ball against this Louisville defense. This defense is a little bit underrated. You know, the offense gets all the publicity, but the reality of it is this is a good defensive football team for Louisville.
Wake scored first on a field goal in the first half, and bear in mind that Jim Grobe is undefeated this year. When the Demon Deacons score first, they do trail at half here. And as we take a look at our first half stats brought to you by Ford, you know, these two teams are really different on paper. Wake Forest doesn't really impress you on paper. Louisville does. But tonight, they look strikingly similar.
Yeah. And again, we've talked so much about the Demon Deacon defense. Rushing yards, only five for the Deacons.
Wow. A look at tonight's impact players in the first half brought to you by Taco Bell. Anthony Allen had the 21-yard catch from Patrick Carter. And by the way, Carter's pass was the first touchdown pass in a FedEx Orange Bowl by a non-quarterback since 1982 when Mike Rozier threw one for Nebraska against Clemson.
How do you keep track of these things?
I have a very gifted staff of people here who are handing the monkey cards.
Matt, I'll tell you one thing that Louisville does that most teams don't do. They actually script their opening drive for the second half. They do this at halftime. And they've been awfully good this year. They script their first six plays and have put pressure on defenses this entire season in the opening drive of the second half.
Kickoff will be kneed upon in the end zone, and Juwan Spillman will take the touchback as Louisville goes to work to start the second half. And we check in once again with Laura Oakman.
All right, Matt, the coaches are echoing what you guys are saying. Bobby Petrino, you don't hear this often. He says, I'm worried about my offense. He says that they're not going to be a lot of possessions in this game. He said, we need to make everyone count. He told me he's most impressed with Wake Forest's heart. I told that to Jim Grobe. He said, I knew they'd come with heart. Now we just have to punch it into the end zone.
First and 10 from the 20 for Louisville. Thank you, Laura. As George Stripling starts the second half as the lone back with Brohm. Gary Barnage in motion. And it's Stripling stuck for a one-yard loss.
You know, Pat, we talked in the first half. I said that one of the things Wake was going to do is try to make Brian Brohm win the game. And
yep.
You made the comment. He can
he
win.
Can.
And he
can.
And I agree with you. But he's going to have to because right now they've not been able, with that big offensive line of Louisville, they've not been able to knock Wake Forest off the ball and be able to control the running game like they normally do.
Reminds me a little bit of the Rose Bowl. USC could not run against Michigan in the first half. They abandoned the run in the second half, and John David Booty really won it for the Trojans.
They split Colby Smith out wide. Brohm looking to throw. He's got Garudio who gets stuck. Maybe a gain of three. Aaron Curry. Curry is a guy that the defensive coordinator Dean Hood told us earlier in the week, this is the first guy off the bus for us. This is the guy we want to lead the charge. This is how big we are. This is how bad we are. Spread out.
Okay, if you're kind of a smallish, wimpy kind of guy like I was, that's the guy you stood next to when you came off the bus because he looks like a player and he plays like one. A really good player.
And he made a great interception against Georgia Tech in the championship game to help win that game for Wake.
Cardinals have been very good on third down this year. 15th best third down conversion rate in the country. Not this time, and Alphonso Smith is having an MVP-like Orange Bowl tonight.
Well, I'll tell you, Alonzo Smith's been awfully good off the edge tonight. One was on a punt, this time right down here, and nobody blocks him. You know, it's a pretty good thing to block Alfonso Smith, Terry, because he's so quick off the corner. Good corner blitz called by Dean Hood.
I know he plays good off the bench. I might think about starting this guy.
Well, he did at the beginning of the year, but kind of pressed too much, they said.
Louisville goes three and out to begin the half. Another near block. And the return starts at the 49. Kenneth Moore tackled just shy of midfield. And Alfonso Smith is all over the field tonight.
The FedEx Orange Bowl on Fox is sponsored by DirecTV. For the most sports in HD, DirecTV. By Charles Schwab. Great service, great price. Why not both? Talk to Chuck, Charles Schwab. And by Verizon Wireless.
Welcome back to Miami. Great field position once again for Wake in their first second half possession. Riley Skinner, after a 10 for 13 first half in which he hit his last six attempts, looks to throw again on first and 10. And he's got a wide open target once more. Willie Idolette near the 30-yard line. Idolette out of bounds at the 31 as they pick on Rod Council, who makes just his fourth start of the year tonight.
I'll tell you, good route by Willie Idolette. But again, once again, Riley Skinner does a great job of giving himself a chance to get this ball off. Just kind of scrambled out of the pocket a little bit. And then Idolette does a thing a quarterback loves when he comes back to catch the ball and meet it early.
Four receptions, a game high 63 receiving yards for the track star. On first and 10, here's Skinner looking downfield again. This time he dumps it off for a short gainer. Idolette once more tackled at the 30-yard line. But one of these days, one of these punts, we're going to have trouble with Getchy and a corner coming at him.
Yeah, just a moment ago, Alfonso Smith just missed it. Now, if that looks familiar, he missed one in the first half. I mean, it could have been two block punts by Alfonso Smith.
I tell you, Louisville's punt team has got to find number two and get him located and make sure they get a blocker on him, because he's just come dangerously close to blocking a punt, and it's all been back in Louisville's area of the field.
Second and 8, Belton and Moore in the backfield with Skinner. They reset Zach Selman before the snap. Skinner buying some time, a wide open Nate Morton touchdown, Demon Deacons. A 30-yard touchdown strike.
Well, Terry, you said, hey, Riley Skinner, well, you said it's 10 of 13 in the first half. Let's give him some more chances. But Riley Skinner gets out of the pocket one more time. A very clean route by Nate Morton. Nobody touches him or jams him at the line of scrimmage. A complete breakdown in the Louisville defensive backfield.
I think Riley Skinner's a guy that's heating it up right now, yeah. And he may be the difference in taking Wake to a big win here tonight if he can keep hitting those kind of balls.
Tonight's Great Area Looks brought to you by Budweiser Select. A 10-10 draw as the Wake Forest Demon Deacons strike first. They strike fast to open the second half. A three-play, 52-yard drive, just over a minute. Riley Skinner 3 for 3 on the drive, and the big touchdown pass to Nate Morton, his fourth TD catch of the year.
Hey, you obviously see why Riley Skinner was the ACC Rookie of the Year. He's played great.
Sam Swank kicks it away. Juwan Spillman, the deep man for Louisville. And he'll take a knee. And Brom will take over at the 20.
Let's go back and have a look at this touchdown and watch how Nate Morton came wide open. I think what really happens, you're going to see a double post route here. That kind of takes the coverage. And then Nate Morton kind of sneaks right behind them and is wide open. The corner at the top of the screen kind of bites on the post. And Nate Morton was the number one option the entire way. Well schemed by Steve Lebosky. the offensive coordinator, and a perfect execution by Riley Skinner.
And when you play in a bowl game, you always worry about big mental mistakes. Yeah. And the right corner for Louisville had a big mental mistake. He sucked inside on that post and all of a sudden left that whole area of the field open for Skinner to hit a wide open Morton.
Back to even, a double tight end set on the field with Brown. And on first and 10, Brown has, or rather, Brock Bolin out of the backfield, who's tackled at the 40, a Louisville first down. John Abate there on the stop for the Deeks.
You know, we talked about Louisville now. They've got to respond. This, I think Louisville has the potential to be a top five team. And they've got to respond here now. They're in a tough ball game with a heavy underdog. The longer the underdog lives, the more he believes he can win, right?
Absolutely.
And so Louisville needs to come right back here and respond and take the fight to Wake Forest.
First and 10 from the 41. The previously injured thumb of Brian Brom. This is Stripling up ahead to the 45. Jeremy Thompson made the tackle for Wake. You know, we talk about the thumb problem that Brom overcame, and he came back a lot quicker than what some people had feared in Louisville. And there was some strategy as to when he was brought back in terms of the strength of the schedule.
Well, all I know is that in the last part of the season, those last three games, he was magnificent. Only 10 touchdowns, but he has not been in rhythm today because the Wake Forest defense has taken these dangerous wide receivers away for the most part.
Barnage in motion, and a quick hand up the middle to delay. Everybody buys it, including us. Brom's pass is incomplete, intended for Douglas. That's how sneaky the offense can be, because we all bought the fake. You know, to get back to your point on Brom, Pat, though, how good he was at the end of the regular season. His last two games, four touchdowns, over 300 yards in each game. There was no concern over Brian Brom's thumb problem by the time the season ended.
Yeah. Football's a game of third downs, right? You got to convert on third downs. You got to defend on third down. We have a critical third down very early in this third quarter, but this is a big play for both of these teams.
Louisville 1 of 5 on third down tonight. They reset Jimmy Riley. Brom's pass is caught by Harry Douglas for a Louisville first down.
You know, Dean Hood, the defensive coordinator of Wake Forest, was saying to us about a week ago that, hey, Brian Brom knows where he's going with the football. You see that? He looked left first, nothing there. He immediately came back, found a third receiver on the right side for the first down. And Terry, you said it was a big third down, and Brian Brom responded.
Louisville's responded so far on this drive. They're coming back with their rhythm. They're trying to hit those receivers.
But it hasn't been easy, has it?
No, they're working for it.
Yeah, they've had a lot of big plays this year, but really not today.
Colby Smith being pursued by Aaron Curry. He gets away from Curry and runs for another Cardinals first down. Into the secondary that time before Patrick G could make the tackle.
And Bobby Petrino was talking to us about all three of his running backs, and he said about Colby Smith, you know, he can do it all for us. Runs, catches, blocks.
Colby Smith kind of bounces this ball outside. The play's really designed, looked like, to go inside. He saw some space outside, and then he punishes the Wake defense there. And that's what the running backs have to do. Smith, Allen, those guys have got to begin to punish the Wake and wear them down.
To Yerudia and into coverage. Ball comes loose. Wake Forest football.
I think this one's going to be reviewed as well. And they're all reviewed. I thought he might have been down, Terry.
Yeah, we thought the last one was down, and we got overruled by the replay official.
Well, you could see Kevin Patterson jump the route.
No, that ball came out. Yeah, that ball came out.
Review.
They're going to take another look at it. And you know, we're 0-for-1 in guessing what these replays are going to yield tonight, guys. But this one looks pretty clear.
Yeah, I think that one, it comes out. Kevin Patterson was the one who strips it.
I think Aaron Curry made the hit from behind.
You know, in watching these two teams practice, I really was concerned that Patterson, Swanson, Smith, I didn't think they'd hold up tonight like they've been able to hold up.
It's both of those guys, Patterson and Curry, both in on the play. John Abate jumped on the loose football.
Well, I'm going to take a stab at this one. I think this ball is out. I think that's out.
Well, you're talking about a Wake Forest defense that forced a turnover in every game this year.
Well, you go back to, you know,
irrefutable evidence. This to me is a closer call than the last one that didn't go Wake's way. This one I think will go Wake's way. I think this ball is turned over.
Tell you one thing I think Louisville's going to have to do is double move these defensive backs because they're jumping routes.
Yeah.
And they're jumping routes like that. You got to double move them and get them off you.
Great point.
My first of 2007.
Boy, it was an impressive looking drive. On the sixth play, however, the pass intended for Yerudia put us into this situation where they're taking a look rather upstairs.
Well, you know, you when you're playing as an underdog in a bowl game like this, you have to live on turnovers. And Jim Grope said, hey, we've got to get some turnovers to win this game. And if we don't, we're going to be in trouble. But we've gotten turnovers all year long, and I expect to get them in the bowl game.
And this is how they've done it. This is how Wake has done this all year long.
After further review, the play stands as called on the field.
Coach Petrino is livid.
That's as livid as a former math major gets. A math major at Carroll College.
It's fait accompli at this point. You just got to get your team together and just keep playing through all the highs and the lows of these football games. There's so many momentum shifts that happen to your team in nights like this. You just keep playing. That's all you do. You play the whole game and just keep it going.
Well, the second turnover tonight, and it's been a tough night for Yerudia.
Sideline warning against Louisville bench. That is their first warning.
Oh, boy.
Now you just got it. You got to make sure you don't get a 15-yard penalty. You know, you're right in this game. This is a real, real tough ball game for both teams. Just keep your cool and keep playing.
Some of that emotion spilleth over on the Louisville sideline. Kenneth Moore in the backfield with Skinner. Time to throw it. That's Moore across the 30-yard line. There he goes, cutting through the defense and tackled across midfield by Preston Smith. A 22-yard gain on first down.
Well, you love it when your quarterback can throw a 5-yard pass and your running back can go ahead and take it all the way up the field for you, right?
This is
a little swing pass by Skinner. It's a really nice athletic throw by him. He gets the ball to a good athlete in Kenneth Moore, and Wake Forest moves the chains. That's a huge offensive play for this team.
The double reverse, it's back to the quarterback, Skinner, and he overthrows Kenneth Moore. Oh, flipping it around, razzle-dazzle style here. And as you talked about earlier, Pat, there's nothing tricky about that. This is their offense.
This is their offense. You know, you go down there to the garbage can and hang a hook pattern and all go deep and you kind of wing it. They've been doing it successfully all year. And you know, you give these coaches, particularly the offensive coordinator, Steve Levitsky, some credit. I mean, they really changed their offense when their starting quarterback, Benjamin Mock, got hurt, and they had to go to their third team, Riley Skinner, but it's worked out pretty doggone well.
Boy, you can sense the tide turn in this game, much like you sensed it last night in the second half in the Tostitos Fiesta Bowl, when things just conspired against Oklahoma. Skinner keeps it, being chased. And incomplete, intended for Kevin Marion. Adrian Grady applying the pressure.
Brandon Sharp was defending. Brandon Sharp played high school football with Riley Skinner, both from Bowles High School in Jacksonville, Florida. Riley Skinner wasn't heavily recruited by Wake Forest. He really was their last guy in their 2005 class. They were looking at one of his teammates, John Russell, the defensive lineman. The coaches from Bowles High School said, hey, you've got to take a look at this guy. They did. They gave him their last scholarship, and he's gone 11-2.
Third and 10 now. A series of third and longs for Wake. Batted down incomplete. William Gay had a shot at a pick there. If he could finish with a circus catch, instead it'll bring on Sam Swank in the punting unit.
Well, William Gay's had a real nice season. 5 interceptions and their second leading tackler, so he can play in space like he did there, but he can come up and stuff the run as well.
William Gay's a tall corner. You know, both the corners
for Louisville are 5'11". Those are big corners by today's standards, you know, and he's got long arms. That time looked like he had a pick, just didn't handle the ball quite as well as he might.
There have been a total of 72 return yards all year against Sam Swain. Zero on this punt.
That's incredible. 72 return yards. Total all year.
Nothing here as a fair catch is called for, and Bobby Petrino's guys have got to fire it up here in Miami. Watching all up and down Tobacco Road tonight are hoping big time upset. We're tied at 10 apiece with 7:56 left in the third quarter from the FedEx Orange Bowl. Worst starting field position of the night for Louisville. And just past the 14-yard line is where Anthony Davis makes the stop, a 3-yard gain on first down.
You know, there's been a lot of big plays by Wake Forest. Alfonso Smith, almost 2-block punts and all that. But how about Sam Swank? Has he backed him up all night? I know he missed the field goal, but he has really made it tough on Louisville. You know, it's hard to call offense when you're on your own 13-yard line. I'm just telling you, you get real nervous when you start thinking about, I better not turn it over down here. You need to play aggressively, but you got to be careful.
You really can't think that way when you're throwing it, you're chucking it.
Colby Smith.
I was thinking, you know, they have not been able to run the ball with any sort of consistency whatsoever. Remember, this is a game, our team, Louisville Cardinals, that was very balanced. They average almost 300 yards passing, almost 200 yards rushing, but they've gotten really nowhere on the ground.
You know, the defensive line for Wake Forest has moved a lot tonight. You know, the defensive tackles, Stukes and Russell, those guys are only 250 pounds. You know, and they're playing against an offensive line that's well over 300 pounds. But those guys are Smith, Thompson, they're all moving all the time, so they're difficult to block and they're penetrating. That's disrupting Louisville a little bit.
Empty backfield here is a split. George Stripling out wide. The pass to Gary Farnish, well shy of a first down, as Aaron Curry was there to wrap him up.
Aaron Curry is just a stout guy versus the run and the pass. That was really more of a run than a pass. Give him a quick little throw to the tight end, but Aaron Curry stuffs the run, rushes the passer. Bunch of tackles against Maryland would send him to the ACC championship game. How about Alfonso Smith? You think they had to block him this time?
Tie number two.
Tie number two. He's up at the top. And they blocked him that time.
Idolette deep for a great punt that time as Idolette takes it across the 40-yard line. A flag on the return as Idolette's tackled at the 43. A 50-yard punt by Corey Getchie and a 9-yard return, pending the flag. On Wake Forest.
Well, that's a big penalty on Wake Forest. They were going to have terrific field position. And, you know, football, we all talk about it. It's clearly a game of field position, particularly when you're trying to win with your defense and your kicking.
During the return, illegal block in the back. Number 81 on the receiving team. 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. First down.
Coach, the more I'm around you, you sound more and more like Bobby Dodd. Kick it, play defense.
Whatever it takes to win, baby.
The FedEx Orange Bowl on Fox is sponsored by Tostitos. Nothing brings people together like Tostitos tortilla chips and salsa. Good things happen at the Tostitos. By Blockbuster Total Access, now offering movies through the mail plus movies through the store. And by Ford, introducing the all-new Ford Edge. The edge is never dull.
Well, the Wake Forest Demon Deacons, in just their second ever January bowl game, guys, are tied here with one of the offensive giants of college football this year. And certainly for those of you that like to watch upsets in the making, and after last night's Tostitos Fiesta Bowl, we are walking down perhaps a similar path tonight.
Well, Terry led the blueprint for Wake Forest at the very top of the show, and they're following that. They're playing great defense, forcing some turnovers.
And look at the huge seam for Kenneth Moore. Finally ran down by Malik Jackson after a 28-yard gain.
the biggest run of the evening for either team, I believe. I say the patience of the running game, Terry, it's so hard to keep running it when you get stuffed. But they were patient, and they finally get an opening for Kenny Moore.
And they have been patient. You're right, Pat. They kept going back to the run, going back to the run. They haven't made a lot of rushing yards, but they've kept Louisville's defense honest. But Louisville's defense is playing well. They've only given up 10 points.
Right.
I think they're an underrated defensive football team.
On the reverse, it's Kevin Marion who loses his footing at the 45. What, Pat, you laid the number out there at the top of the telecast that wideouts on the Demon Deacons roster have carried the football 70 times this year.
Yeah, isn't that amazing?
Yeah.
And the quarterback, Riley Skinner, we talked at the very top how he's kind of featured as a blocker on some of these. And watch number 11 at the top. Never mind, don't watch him. Never mind.
He looked like a quarterback.
Never mind.
He looked like a quarterback.
That wasn't a good block.
A loss of two on the sweep. Over the middle and incomplete, intended for Nate Morton, who is lobbying for a penalty flag. William Gay had the coverage for Louisville.
Hey, William Gay, good coverage and a good game for William Gay. You know, Mike Cassidy, the defensive, one of the co-defensive coordinators, was talking with a couple of weeks ago about William Gay and their corners, and said, you know, we put so much pressure on our corners. They're out there all alone because it's going to stop the run, and those guys have to respond, and William Gay has most of this season.
Yeah, I like their two corners. I like Gay. I also like Council. And, you know, they lost Gavin Smart with a broken leg, so they're really out without their first-string corner.
After the great start to the half, Riley Skinner over his last four, third and 12 now. And the pass is caught for a first down by Kevin Marion. A great sliding grab.
How many third and longs has Wake Forest been in this game? Seems like every third down has been a third and long, and Riley Skinner has been able to respond.
In fact, all eight of their third down attempts have been from third and long this evening. That was a 16-yard pickup.
So they've had eight plays of third down. Every one of them has been 10 or more.
Moore and Belton in the backfield here with Skinner.
Need to do better on first and second down.
Make it a little easier on himself. Belton, the ball carrier, up ahead and steamrolling inside the red zone. Tackled at the 14 into the secondary before Brandon Sharp can stop him.
Ball came out. The ball came out. I saw one official point Louisville ball, and they did, didn't they?
Indeed, Louisville football.
Ball came out late.
On a play that will no doubt be reviewed upstairs.
Rich Belton, the big fullback, you're looking at a 250-pound ball carrier here. He finds a little crease in that defense, takes it up inside. You can't really see from that angle whether or not he was down, but it looks like it was ripped out.
Well, William Gay, number 21, we just talked about it, ripping out. That ball is out. I'm one for two. That ball was out. I think that's a fumble. Great play by William Gay.
And now we're going to have a stoppage to take a look upstairs.
The one official on the side was right on top of it and called
play under further review.
And called Louisville recovered immediately.
Well, you know, I like this review system in college football. I mean, they really are working at trying to get it right. You know, as you mentioned, Pat, this is an all-star crew of officials. They don't necessarily work on the same crew throughout the season. They're rewarded to come here to the Orange Bowl, the FedEx Orange Bowl, because they've had such a great season. They've done a nice job tonight. They've got total control of this game. I've been impressed with the way the officials have handled this game, and I love the review system because it keeps mistakes from hurting the football team.
And I think, you know, if you love the review, then you've got to call that a fumble because William Gay kind of absolutely stripped Belton of the ball before he was down.
I think it'll stand, and what an opportunistic turn of events for the Louisville defense.
Yeah.
You know, again, I think this defense gets so overshadowed because the offense gets so much attention in Louisville, and the head coach is an offensive coach, but this defensive football team, Mike Cassidy, Kevin Woolhouse, and the two co-defensive coordinators, they do a nice job with these guys.
Well, if it holds up as a turnover, it'll be the fourth of the game.
Well,
an angry roar from the ball carrier.
See that expression much from 1,400 SAT students?
No, but he knows he's got to go over and see Jim Grobe and
you know, take care of the ball.
Oh, yeah.
Right?
I hate that.
After review, video evidence confirms the call on the field of a fumble, first down.
Yeah, they got it right again. So you have 2 for 3 so far, Terry.
Well, we're getting better.
Yeah.
You know, we've talked a lot about how effective the secondary has been of the Wake Forest Demon Demons. The secondary of the Cardinals making that play happen.
Yeah.
After Belton had broken off a big run, Sharp and Russell knocking the ball out. William Gay was there from corner, and Louisville flat takes it back inside the red zone.
These two guys need to step up, too. They're two wide receivers.
Braun with play action, looking for the big bomb. Down the sideline for Harry Douglas. There he is, out of bounds at the 37. Exactly what the Cardinal faithful has been looking for tonight.
Well, I'll tell you, the coach told us, Bobby Petrino said, Wake Forest has not seen the kind of speed that Harry Douglas is going to get. There's the double move. Remember, we talked about that just a little while ago. A little out and up and runs right by Kevin Patterson. A perfect throw by Brian Brohm. So the defense set it up. Brian Brohm delivers.
And how much time did Brian Brohm have to throw that ball? You talk about protection. Yeah. What a great job by Louisville's offensive line.
First and 10 from the 37 after the 50-yard gain. In the air again is Brohm. And this pass is caught by Colby Smith out of the backfield shy of the 30-yard line.
Yeah, I was just looking at Kurt Quarterman talking about offensive linemen. He's number 76, one of the guards for Louisville. Great protection that time again by Kurt Quarterman. The guy who came in at nearly 400 pounds is kind of settled in at 328, named in honorary Clydesdale a little bit earlier in the week. Big old guy that's made that all Big East team.
An additional receiver has checked in for Louisville, Patrick Carter, the junior out of St. Petersburg. Colby Smith and Garyonte Taylor in the backfield. This is Colby Smith crossing the 25 and tackled by Patrick G.
It's amazing in football what a big play will do in terms of momentum, changing momentum. All of a sudden, you know, Louisville's backed up on their own 12-yard line. Brohm gets all day long. He finds Douglas down the right sideline, like you say, Pat, on that double move, which was a really smooth, nice-looking move by him. And all of a sudden, Louisville looks like they're back in rhythm again. And Wake's trying to hang on to this two-headed monster.
Running with some confidence behind their two all-conference linemen on the right side. First and 10 now. Brown's pass is incomplete, intended for Yerudia.
The total yards are kind of indicative of a 10-10 game, wouldn't you say?
Absolutely. And when Wake Forest is lockstep right there in terms of total offense tonight with Louisville.
But don't you sense that Louisville at any moment can turn it on and get a big play?
You watch that big pass completion to Harry Douglas, that's the kind of stuff they've done all year. Brock Bolden, the lone back with Brohm. Second and 10. For Douglas, complete shy of a first down. Kevin Patterson had the coverage for Wake.
I thought we were talking to Dave Wanstead earlier today. He made a good point. We talked about Louisville. You know, this Big East Conference, it's been a tough conference and a very good conference this year. Three teams that have a chance of being the top 15 by the end of the year, and perhaps this is the best one. They won the conference, and they have a chance of finishing perhaps the top five.
3-0 in bowls so far. And Brohm hoping the Biggie stays undefeated. Third and a yard. Again, they go behind the right side of the line, but Anthony Allen is stopped shy of a first down. Kevin Patterson came in from corner to apply the tackle.
Well, one thing about the secondary of Wake Forest, they will hit you. Patterson, Swanson, the two safeties, Gaddis, Gee. You can hear this hit all the way up here. That's a nice looking tackle by a cornerback.
Yeah.
You know, you expect your safeties to run support like that. That is a really nice looking tackle.
Yeah, gets a 225-pound short yardage back.
The most accurate field goal kicker in Louisville history, Art Carmody, is no good from 32 yards away. And guess who was in the middle of that one?
Alfonso Smith. Unbelievable off the corner again. Alphonso Smith has effected two punts and a kick. Looked like a pretty good snap. Oh, a little slippage, a little delay, and that gave Alphonso Smith a little bit of time to effect the kick.
Well, I don't know that I've seen a special teams guy licking his chops the way Alphonso Smith has been tonight. Yeah. Every time he gets on the field, he's made an impact.
You got to find number two, guys.
And they haven't.
Find number two and put a blocker right on him.
Get a big old 76 or something on him.
Moore again. Look at him go. Down the sideline is Kenneth Moore. Pushed out of bounds in Louisville territory. Rod Council may have prevented a breakaway TD run. Mark it as a 35-yard gainer for Kenneth Moore in the midst of a huge second half.
You know, late in this third quarter, Terry, Wake Forest has found the secret sauce in the running game. You know, and they've been getting a couple of two big runs out of Kenny Moore, and then also Rich Belton, the fullback, had a big run. So they hammered it and hammered it and got stuffed for three and a half quarters, but they've had three big running plays late in the third quarter.
And that helps the throwing game. Once you get balance in your offense, then the quarterback can feel the freedom of the pocket and make big plays for you.
D'Angelo Bryant, the ball carry, chewing off yardage. Bryant's good for a gain of eight before being stopped by Malik Jackson.
You know, we talked about Louisville's offensive line, but this offensive line of Wake Forest has come to life. Steve Ballas, the All-American tackle, number 75, a guy that is probably as versatile as any offensive lineman in the country. See him at left tackle there. He plays two series at right tackle, and then he'll flip over and play one series as the left tackle.
And how about Steve Justice, the center? He plays every play and never comes out of the ball game, and he is a really fine center.
D'Angelo Bryant again right up the middle and tackled at the 25.
Boy, in the second half, have there been a few shifts in momentum with turnovers, with kicks, with the whole way the football game has gone? These are two heavyweight fighters slugging it out, if you will, and they are pounding on each other right now.
And a perfect script for Wake Forest, trying to get to the fourth quarter in a close game. We said at the very top, they've won four games this year in the last minute of a ball game. They're going to get to this fourth quarter, perhaps tied, maybe with the lead.
Bryant still on the field. Bryant, the ball carrier. And he pushes ahead for a gain of three.
Those direct snaps to the runners, that time to D'Angelo Bryant. They, again, part of their offense, not one of those trick plays. He'll line up in shotgun formation and take it and just run off tackle. You know, Darren McFadden at Arkansas has done it. Derek Williams at Penn State does it some.
Would have never thought coming into this game that Wake Forest would be out-rushing Louisville right now. You know, I just didn't anticipate that. Wake Forest has gotten into the fourth quarter. They've gotten the game just the way they want it. Now, Louisville, if they want to be the champion, they've got to respond.
The five fingers up in saluting John Abadi, his late brother and family, and Wake Forest has Louisville right where they want him. Start of the fourth quarter. Here are tonight's air and ground leaders brought to you by FedEx. Riley Skinner, 15 for 22 with a touchdown and 215 yards in the air. And on the ground, what a second half so far for Kenneth Moore. 12 carries, 73 yards.
Oh, that was a nice move there, wasn't it?
Good thing. Had an ankle problem just a few weeks ago. Healthy and running hog wild tonight. Here's Kevin Marion around the corner. Forced out of bounds inside the 20 by Rod Council.
How about Kevin Marion? He is a wide receiver, at least as you look at the roster. But coming in tonight's game, he had 20 carries and only six receptions. Again, that's just the style of their offense. They're going to run a lot of reverses, misdirection.
You mentioned 70 carries for wideouts. A normal season for most football teams, wide receivers might carry the ball 10 times.
Yeah, yeah.
Put it in perspective, you know, probably 10 reverses a year.
Well, they had some guys get hurt at running back and said, let's get the ball in the hands of our speedy wide receivers.
This is the friendliest third down conversion opportunity the Dukes have had, and the pass is incomplete.
Well, guys, you talk about a well-coached football game. Louisville's had one penalty for 5 yards, and Wake Forest has had two penalties for 15 yards. I mean, both of these coaches have really prepared for this game. I think anytime you come into a bowl game and you're really low on the penalty ladder, you've done a great job with your staff preparing your football team to play.
This will be from 36 yards away for Sam Swain. True to form this time, is up and good. Dukes take a 13-10 lead at the 14:46 mark in the fourth quarter. Let's send you down to the field and check in with Laura.
Matt, you just saw one of the most inspirational stories for Wake Forest, let alone in sports, a few moments ago, heading into the fourth quarter. Every game this year, Wake Forest fans hold up 5 fingers, and that is in honor of Luke Abadi's brother, Luke, who was killed in a car accident last February. I'm sitting here right now with his family, with his mother, Mary Ann, his brother, Adam, his father, Stephen, and he said, you've never seen so many fives.
It was unbelievable. I've never seen so many fives in my life. It was absolutely, I've never been so honored in my entire life.
I can't even imagine a better definition of the word bittersweet.
Exactly. It's a God moment. It's the moment where just people come together and they just are supporting, and it's just amazing.
Can you believe how much it's caught on?
Yeah, it's very bittersweet, but I'm so moved by the support of all the Wake people and really just the football community.
You've been so wonderful, your whole family, about letting us all invade your privacy. How has this Orange Bowl been? I know how much you've talked about how much Luke would have wanted to be here.
Luke would have loved every moment of this, and he is here today. We say number 5's alive. Thank you.
Yeah, we'll be alive forever.
He's here.
Thank you so much. I'll let you enjoy the game. You've been so wonderful. Thank you, Abadi family.
Laura, thanks. Really one of the uplifting stories here at the FedEx Orange Bowl this year. And John Abadi is playing with all kinds of inspiration tonight. 9 tackles as Juwan Spillman bobbles the kick and is able to bring it back to the 20-yard line.
You know, one of the things I liked about John Abadi when we met with him just the other day, Terry, he was talking to us. He said, hey, not only, you know, he said, what do you have to do? We've got to stop the run. But, and that's where most guys end it. But he said, you know, not only are we going to stop the run, we've got to stop the stretch play. We've got to stop the dart play and the counter play. I mean, he was very, very specific of what they needed to do in stopping Louisville's run.
Well, he's instinctive. You lead your team 3 years in a row in tackles, you're getting around the football. You diagnose plays well. This guy can read and diagnose.
Play action, Brock keeps looking down center field, and he has Eric Douglas for a first down.
Yeah, but he would have had Mario Rudia for a touchdown.
Boy, I agree, Pat. He missed that. Brian Brohm, when he looks at this film, he's going to regret. He had a wide open Rudia right down the middle of the field for a touchdown. I promise you, the coaches in the press box, they saw that. They'll probably come back to that.
You know, we don't know what Brian Brohm saw, but it looked like he was at least gazing in the direction of Rudia, and for some reason went to the secondary target there. Rudia has had a rough night. Brohm swings it out here to Colby Smith, who gets away from a tackle, has a first down and more. G and Abadi finally trip him up at the 35.
Colby Smith is a good all-around back. You know, fourth in the team in receptions. 24th catch on the year for Colby Smith. Good, productive runner. Remember, one of those guys, one of the trio, filling in for the injured Michael Bush. He had to adjust to that ball. Then he broke a tackle. Then some speed. See how he switched the ball to get to the ball to the outside hand. Did a lot of good things on that run.
Ducked right underneath Stanley Arnoux and broke off a 19-yard gainer as Brohm has come back with an impressive second half tonight, to the surprise of no one watching at home. There's Rudia, taken out of bounds by Riley Swanson, shy of a first down.
Boy, it's a nice job by Louisville responding to the drive of Wake Forest and the score by Wake Forest on the 3-point kick there. All of a sudden, Louisville's feels that sense of urgency. You know, they're on the sideline, they're looking up there and saying, hey, we've got a real dogfight here, but they're responding. I mean, this, you know, this is a big-time team. They've been in tough games before. They have responded. They just got to get that ball in the end zone.
Not too many times, though. They have been in, not in too many dogfights. They've blown a lot of people out this year.
Douglas in motion in a double tight end set. This is Anthony Allen. This is actually Brom keeping the football and finding Brock Boland. Boland marked out of bounds at the 15. First down inside the red zone for the Cardinals.
Brock Boland, the fullback, is the guy that slips out of the backfield. It's a nice job by Brian Brom finding his fullback. It's a little play action fake. He's got good protection. He finds that fullback in the flat. It's a nice throw. He puts the ball right where he wants to. And then that big old fullback turns it upfield. Now that's a load turning up on you.
Boland the lone back here. And Boland bruises ahead for a gain of three before being stopped by Aaron Curry.
Yeah, Paul Petrino, the offensive coordinator, also the brother of Bobby, who said, hey, we like Brock Boland as a single back, and sometimes when we want to mash it, we just put it back there by himself and feed it to him.
That's a big physical fullback there. Dean Hood, the defensive coordinator from Wake Forest, right now he's thinking, just don't give up 7 points. You know, Wake Forest has been really good in the red zone, scoring defense, 10th nationally. They're really good down in here. They've made big plays all year long. He's thinking, give up a field goal, but not a touchdown.
Brom sells the play fake again into the corner and incomplete. Boy, Riley Swanson had Mario Urrutia absolutely blanketed in the corner of the end zone.
You know, why did they throw it up to Mario Urrutia? Well, he's 6'6". You know, just tremendous size advantage over virtually every defensive back in the league. Swanson, a good player, tall player. He's only 5'11". He's got 7 inches on.
And Urrutia is a basketball player. He's got leaping ability as well. You know, so you're not just talking about a tall receiver. You're talking about one that really can leap. He was a forward in high school basketball.
And here he is again up here at the top.
Third and seven.
Oop, hooks him.
And around the corner is Colby Smith, knocked out of bounds inside the five. They mark him out at the 1.5-yard line. Aaron Curry forced him out of bounds and prevented the touchdown.
You know, they picked up the first, right? But the way he was running, I thought it was Anthony Allen, the big physical back, freshman, the short yardage guy, but it was Colby Smith.
Well, it's hard to keep track of these backs. You've got Smith coming at you. You've got Anthony Allen. You've got Boland coming at you. Stripling. I mean, there's a lot of guys coming at you if you're playing defense for Wade.
It's Allen back there now. Allen, the ball carrier, stopped shy of the goal line. No, on second look, they signal touchdown. It looked like the play was dead, and the line judge came in and said touchdown.
Just remember, any part of that ball that crosses any part of that white line where the end zone begins is a touchdown. It's the ball. Where is the ball?
Oh, boy, that's a tough one to look at. And it looked like the motor had stopped, but Allen kept the legs pumping to keep the play alive.
Well, John Russell hit him early. Oh, I don't think his legs are down. His knee's down there. And he kept moving and churning. John Russell, number 51 from Wake Forest, drilled him early, but the churning legs of Anthony Allen get in the end zone.
The Carmody PAT is good. And with that, Louisville takes a 17-13 lead. 12.5 minutes left here at the FedEx Orange Bowl.
The FedEx Orange Bowl on Fox is sponsored by Smith Barney. Come to Smith Barney, where wealth works. By Dodge, you can take life as it comes, or you can grab life by the horns, Dodge. And by Taco Bell, official fan of college bowl action.
Coming up on Monday, it's the game college football fans have been waiting for. Chris Leak and the Gators take on Heisman Award winner Troy Smith and the Buckeyes in the first ever Tostitos BCS National Championship game. Our coverage begins Monday at 7:30 p.m. Eastern, 4:30 Pacific in high definition, only on Fox. Tonight's beautiful aerial view brought to you by Budweiser Select. We got a pretty good view at the goal line. What was ruled a touchdown for Anthony Allen. And with it, Louisville has taken a 17-13 lead. 12:31 left on the regulation clock as Todd Flannery is sent to kick it away for the Cardinals. Well, Louisville went into this fourth quarter tied. This is Kevin Marion at the goal line. Hit hard at the 15-yard line. Ball popped out.
Let's have another look at that touchdown run by Anthony Allen a moment ago. And guys, I think when he was moving, he was on a bunch of bodies, so I don't think his knee was ever on the ground. And he kept moving and churning. I don't think he's down there. And then he turned and twisted and crossed the goal line. I think that's a good call for a touchdown.
I'm surprised they didn't review it, though. You know, it is a close call, and it is a powerful run now by Anthony Allen. Now, that is a power run. He got hit in the backfield, kept his pad level low, and just powered that thing in there. I am surprised, though, that they've looked at a lot of calls tonight. That was a big call.
So now it's Riley Skinner and the Deacon Demons at the 15 with Belton and Moore in the backfield. Kenneth Moore is in the midst of a fine second half rushing. Pass is complete to Rich Belton, stuck at the 12-yard line by Abe Brown. A loss of 3 yards on the play.
Yeah, these outside linebackers for Louis, Honest Abe Brown and Malik Jackson, they've had a big year for the Cardinals. You mentioned the BCS championship game on Monday. The Cardinals are hoping to win this thing tonight, be a top five team in the preseason polls next year, and perhaps challenge.
Louisville playing in its ninth straight bowl game tonight.
First BCS game.
And they have had no success at all in this state as that pass is batted around. It looked like it was intended for Nate Morton, and Skinner may have decided if he had a second chance to hang on to it, because Adrian Grady was all draped on him when he made that throw.
Hey, Adrian Grady's been draped on Riley Skinner a lot today.
Yeah, that was a really nice power rush right there by Grady. He just lowered his shoulder pads, got underneath the offensive blocker, and just pushed him into the quarterback.
Was that leverage again? Was that leverage thing?
It's a different
thing?
Kind of leverage, but it's leverage.
I thought it was leverage. Big play or big down right here for Wake Forest.
And another third and long for the Demon Deacons.
Yeah, it's a common theme.
They are 3 of 9 on third down tonight. Third and 11. They hand it off to Belton, who comes close to but shy of a Wake Forest first down.
Surprising call for me, third and 11. I know they've had some success running the football, but a surprising call. Riley Skinner's been pretty good.
So on comes the punting unit. It's a 10-yard gain on the run, falling just short of a first down.
You wouldn't dare call a fake punt here, would you, Coach?
You know, I don't like the formation for fake punts. I do like fake punts, but I don't like this formation particularly. But, you know, they sometimes move their punter to the right. Sometimes they move the launch point for the punter if they expect to block.
Guy and Spillman are deep for Louisville. They let it bounce. It takes a decidedly Wake bounce. And they're going to mark it at the 26.
We're not sure where they're going to mark it.
We're sure of this. We'll be back with 10:22 left. Sunday on Fox, the NFC wildcard battle in Philadelphia as the Eagles play host to their rivals, the New York Giants. Coverage begins with this pregame show at 4 p.m. Eastern, 1 p.m. Pacific this Sunday right here on Fox. Tiki Barber ran wild in the regular season finale against the Redskins to get the G-men into the postseason. And Jeff Garcia has been fantastic in Philly.
Well, Terry, you were general manager of the 49ers when he was there.
Yeah, you can't count Jeff Garcia out of any football game. You talk about mentally tough and physically tough and the guy that makes plays, Garcia makes plays for you. He came off the bench now for Philly.
He always has more fun than he has right now.
He loves it. He loves it.
George Stripling alone back with Bromier on first and 10. This is among Louisville's best starting field position today, believe it or not. Stripling hammered for a loss. John Abadi.
Yeah, John Abadi just has a feel for, you know, penetration and blitzing. And then when he gets there, the ball carrier always seems to go down. You know, a guy that 105 tackles on the year. It's right in the air. And Abadi body. No, this is a body. Excuse me. At the wrong guy's circle. There's a body. Just kind of runs. And look who's trying to run right through. Foster at 325 pounds.
And he leveraged that one now. You saw those shoulder pads. Yeah. He was underneath that big offensive lineman.
You know, the thing with John Abadi is he doesn't have what the scouts might look at first glance in terms of the NFL because he's a smaller linebacker. That pass is complete. They find Jimmy Riley for a gain up to the 34-yard line, and it's Abadi on the tackle again, a pickup of 11 yards, but I want to get back to Abadi, Coach, because smaller guy. You know, there's a pretty good undersized middle linebacker that plays here in Miami on the NFL level, by the way, who some people have been reminded of when they watch John Abadi go to work.
Well, there's no question about it, but John Abadi in the NFL is going to be in the lower 5% of players at his position in terms of his height, so he's got a lot to overcome at the NFL level. He's a great college football player, but it doesn't always translate to pro football.
He sure doesn't stay blocked, I'll say that. They block him initially, but he doesn't stay blocked.
Brown's pass is caught by Harry Douglas, who's taken down at the 42 by Kevin Patterson.
I thought that guy was holding his nose on for a second.
I tell you, Brown is starting to really heat it up here in the second half. I've got him for 14 of 17 in the second half, and he's all of a sudden really come to life here, and he's moved this Cardinal team, and in the second half has certainly been a lot better for their entire offense, but particularly for him.
Don't you expect it of him, though?
Yeah.
You know, great quarterbacks don't get discouraged. Find a way somehow to make the plays to win the game.
Harry Douglas with 137 yards tonight has become the most prolific Louisville pass catcher in history. Anthony Allen in a non-goal line situation.
You know, going back to Harry Douglas, when we watched him practice, he's a glider. He comes out of his breaks. He just glides. He's a beautiful looking athlete catching the ball. And he is so quick when he plants and comes out of breaks. He's a real factor. And I love just the way to, when I watch him, I just love the way he runs and looks as an athlete.
You've got him on one side and a completely different kind of receiver on the other side in Mario Urrutia.
That's why
a big, tall guy. And,
yeah, such a great duo.
Second and nine here. Play action. Brown looking into center field again. There's Harry Douglas once more down at the 35-yard line.
Give him heck, Harry. I mean, how about another one of those deep crossing routes by Harry Douglas?
And doesn't Brian Brown tell you that that's one of his favorite routes to throw, route?
But if he doesn't stumble, you know, he's off to Churchill Downs. He scores, I think.
22-yard pickup for Harry Douglas, who's gotten so hot here, we got to hose him down.
Like practice the other day.
Boy, and you love the relationship again with him and Urrutia. And Urrutia told us earlier, if Douglas is the Steve Smith, Urrutia is the Plaxico Burress, if we may draw NFL comparisons. Into the corner of the end zone, Urrutia, and it's broken up. Riley Swanson has been in his kitchen all night.
You know, Riley Swanson, think about who he's had to guard the last two games. He had Calvin Johnson in the ACC championship game, the great receiver from Georgia Tech, and then another big, tall guy right here. Now, that was face guarding, but in face guarding, in college football, that is not pass interference when you get your hands up in the receiver's face.
And that's exactly right, Pat. In pro football, that is pass interference. That's the difference in the rules right there between the college game and the pro game.
Second and 10, Bolin and Smith in the background. This is Smith, who is met head-on and quite squarely by Jeremy Thompson.
Talk about how Louisville is going to have a good ball club next year. How about this Wake Forest team? This is not kind of a, you know, one-shot deal. Jim Groves has 16 returning starters next year. He's, you know, put his program in place. This is the sixth year he's been the head coach. They're redshirted all those guys. A lot of young guys coming back. This is going to be a pretty good football team next year as well.
And a guy who loves it, Winston Salem. Third and nine now. Pass is caught by Jimmy Riley.
Boy, what a nice job by Riley fighting to get the first down. That ball not necessarily was going to make it to the chains, and I tell you, he was determined to get that ball all the way to the first down marker. This is a really good run after the catch. One of the things Wake Forest talked about is tackling those receivers. Don't give them yards after the catch. On this particular play, Louisville won that battle.
Jimmy Riley caught a total of 8 passes during the regular season. But a big first down reception here as Brian Brohm is up over 300 yards of passing now. And Brohm doesn't like what he sees. He spends a Louisville timeout. 5:37 left on the game clock with Louisville on the march. Time to take a look at our Dodge game summary. We went on the air tonight and talked about the two great quarterbacks. Both of them have been splendid this evening.
Absolutely. And Brian Brohm has really come on the second half. Riley Skinner been efficient as we thought he would be, leading his team, kind of dealing the back there like a good point guard.
And I'll tell you, Anthony Allen, people are going to hear about him around the country. You're talking about a guy that scored 14 touchdowns here in his freshman season at Louisville.
Yeah, 2 tonight.
Well, this is a big series right now for Wake Forest. You know, they've been good in the red zone. They've got to be thinking, just don't give 7 points up. Keep this to 3 points. That's what they've got to be thinking. They're still in this football game if they can hold it to 3 points.
The Michael Bush-less Louisville Cardinals all year long. Play action. Brohm's pass is caught by Harry Douglas down shy of a first down as Kevin Patterson had the coverage for Wake.
Another good tackle by Kevin Patterson.
Really a good diagnose, too, by Kevin Patterson. You know, Louisville tried to slip that receiver out in the flat. Patterson closed on that ball. That was an excellent defensive play.
2nd and 4 now.
You see the people huddling around Bobby Petrino so nobody can read his lips about what play he's sending in.
If I see another coach at any level with a flip card in front of their mouth to prevent the lip readers from doing their jobs, oh, my goodness. It's the big fullback, Brock Bolin. It sprung for an 18-yard touchdown run, and it's a 2-score game.
You know, he catches the ball well. He runs. He blocks. When they have perimeter runs, it's usually Brock Bolin who's leading the way. And it's a concerned Wake Forest student, as he should be.
How about the right side, Pat, of this offensive line? That's about 320 pounds coming off you per man. And they were able that time to just knock a hole in that gutty Wake Forest defense. But they gashed him on that play.
Yeah, you're right. Scott Kuhn, I think, made a backup tight end, made a great block.
The Carmody PAT is good. Brock Bolin's 2nd career rushing TD is a big one, as the Cardinals take a 24-13 lead. We have a flag on the field. Bobby Petrino wants some clarification, as we do here upstairs.
Personal foul. Roughing the snapper, number 55, Wake Forest. That penalty will be enforced 15 yards on the kickoff.
Maybe a frustration penalty from Giles Tucker. Deeks have their backs up to the wall.
The FedEx Orange Bowl on Fox is sponsored by FedEx. For all your shipping needs, relax, it's FedEx. By Gatorade Thirst Quencher. Gatorade, is it in you? And by Allstate, are you in good hands?
What a great moment earlier tonight when one of the ceremonial captains here at the FedEx Orange Bowl, Muhammad Ali, was on the field for the coin toss. He'll be celebrating his 65th birthday later this month. And you can go to www.alicenter.org to learn more about the center and send along your birthday wishes to the champ. That's www.alicenter.org. As the Cardinals continue to do Louisville proud tonight. A great scoring drive engineered by Brian Brohm and capped off by the Brock Bolin touchdown run, as Todd Flannery's ready to kick it away here with 4:57 left.
A 2-score game, what, 11 points, and a touchdown, 2-point play, and a field goal. Bingo. Done.
Kicking off from the 50 after the penalty, and one that will land predictably out of the back of the end zone. Well, here it is, guys. I mean, this is the drive of the night for Riley Skinner and the Demon Deacons.
Riley Skinner has played really well tonight, I think. I've been very impressed. When you think about this guy 2 years down the road, working the pocket, being as accurate as he is, and also knowing the offense a whole lot better than he knows it tonight.
But, you know, you define as a quarterback, I think you define yourself in moments like these.
Boy, a redshirt freshman who already has arguably a signature win this year, looking for some comeback magic tonight. None to be had on this play as Amobi Okoye comes in to drop him for a loss.
You know, Amobi Okoye immigrated to this country from Nigeria when he was 12 years old, right here in the middle. But he said this week, you know, he said this week when he saw his very first football game, American football game, when he lived in Nigeria, he said, why do these guys keep attacking one another? Didn't quite understand the game.
Skinner's pass is caught by D'Angelo Bryant, who gets across the 20. Well, for more on the great Amobi Okoye story, let's go back down to Laura Oakman.
Here's all you need to know about Amobi. 2 years ago, he met a six-year-old boy named Chase at a Louisville hospital after he underwent brain surgery. 2 years later, I'm so happy to say Chase is fine. He's at the game. They're great friends. He calls Amobi before every game, gives him words of inspiration. Before this game, he told him, play your heart out. You and I both know you have the biggest heart out there.
Willie Idelet with the reception around midfield, getting past Okoye and the rest of the Louisville Cardinals defensively. Lord, thanks. But here we have the Demon Deacons perhaps with one last opportunity to stay in the ballgame, completing a big pass.
Pat, you said, you know, quarterbacks distinguish themselves in times like this. Riley Skinner is under tremendous pressure right now because that Louisville defense is just teeing off. They know that Wake Forest has to move the ball and move it throwing. And I'll tell you what, he's playing really lights out. This guy can move around the pocket. He's smart. He makes good decisions.
Skinner chased by Zach Anderson, has to throw it away.
Well, you know, unfortunately, he's got to do it twice, right?
Right.
Two times to get his team back in it. To finish the story on Okoye, you mentioned he graduated 2 weeks ago at age 19. You know, signed a letter of intent when he was age 15. And, you know, had three solid seasons, but this, his senior seasons, Amobi Okoye has really played well.
Let's check in again with Laura.
I asked him why he thought he was playing so well. Ready to feel old, you guys? He told me, just aging.
Yeah. How you feel, Terry?
You know, I feel good.
Just aging at 19. Skinner's pass is caught. Despite the shot, Kevin Marion's able to hang on. And Riley Skinner looks like he was hurt on the play. 13-yard gain that'll move the chains.
Yeah, what I'm impressed with Riley Skinner is how he just kind of hangs in there against the rush and delivers it.
He's cool. He's really cool. This guy will sit in the pocket. The heat doesn't seem to really affect him. He'll step up in the pocket. He'll move to the side, but he's courageous.
Yeah. Now, eyes always downfield.
Clock rolling at 3:18 and counting. To a secondary target is John Tereshinski, his second reception of the game. Abe Brown moves him out of bounds at around the 35. A gain of 4 on the play. And now time is really the biggest enemy for the Wake Forest Demon Deacons here. They've got a 2nd and 6, just over 3 minutes left.
And Louisville's going to give them some of those passes. Oh, yeah. They're going to play in a soft defense, rush 4 guys, sometimes 3.
And 2 very, very deep safeties.
They rush 4 here. Skinner's pass is incomplete, intended for Tereshinski again, who looked like he had gotten behind a corner.
Yeah, I think it was that long arm. Terry was starting with the long arms of William Gay. I think he kind of knocked that one away.
Well, you can sense that the Louisville bench, you know, on a stop here, they're going to get a little froggy. They can sense how close they are to a FedEx Orange Bowl victory. Just over 3 minutes left on the game clock. 3rd and 6. Skinner hangs in. He had a receiver. It's intercepted by William Gay. He tried to get it to Zach Selman. Gay was there.
You know, two really good corners played well today. One for Louisville, William Gay, and one for Wake Forest, Alfonso Smith. But William Gay, Terry, has been close to about two or three interceptions this afternoon.
Yeah, he's an outstanding-looking defensive back, and I think Riley Skinner will learn a lot from that interception, Pat. As you know, quarterbacks grow when they make mistakes and when they make good plays. This ball just doesn't have enough steam on it. He had an open receiver. He just didn't lead him quite enough, just not enough arm strength, but really a nice play by William Gay.
Gay's team-leading sixth interception of the year. And that's all but going to ice things down here with the clock rolling at 2:36 and counting. Double tight end set in there for Louisville. The hand to Colby Smith, tackled at the 21-yard line.
I think you got to give Louisville an awful lot of credit. They came back when they needed to come back. They showed their true grit, really, when this game was on the line.
Tomorrow night, the Tostitos Bowl Bash continues with the All-State Sugar Bowl as the Notre Dame Fighting Irish take on the LSU Tigers in a showdown between two of college football's elite programs. Coverage of the All-State Sugar Bowl begins tomorrow at 7:30 Eastern, 4:30 Pacific, in high definition only on Fox.
Jamarcus Russell, the quarterback for LSU, is huge. He's 6'6", 260 pounds. That's a duck when he goes into the Superdome.
Well, Notre Dame is carrying around a... you know, some bowl baggage. They have not fared very well in post-holiday activity here of late. Coach Charlie Weiss will try to win his first bowl game. Boy, you can see the long faces and the disappointment on the Wake sideline. 2:22 left, a two-score advantage here for Louisville. On second and four, Colby Smith has a first down and more for the Cardinals. Tackled shy of the 40 by Patrick G.
Hey, Patrick G, one of the, I think, interesting stories for Wake Forest, their strong safety. Graduated in 3 years with a degree in computer science and ended up getting his master's, or will this year, his master's in computer science as well.
They say he's a brilliant safety. That's how they
Wake Forest.
Pretty good stoop, too.
Second charge timeout of this half.
Demon Deacons have spent a timeout. Gives us an opportunity to take a look at tonight's All-State Good Hands play of the game. How about a number of plays, actually? Harry Douglas has had a huge night. An Orange Bowl tying night. 10 receptions. He's 5 receiving yards shy of a FedEx Orange Bowl record. Harry Douglas is on his way to MVP honors tonight, guys.
Well, you know, Bobby Petrino had it right. He said he was going to shock Wake Forest with his speed, and indeed he has.
Yeah, and I think you got to give Brian Brohm a lot of credit for it. You know, particularly early in the game, Louisville couldn't run the ball.
Yeah.
And Brohm in the second half, he got hot. He heated it up. He played very, very well.
Yeah, Brian Brohm will certainly be a candidate for MVP honors tonight as well. Between he and Douglas, you can't go wrong there.
Think he'll come back, Terry? I think Brian Brohm will be back?
You know, I'm just not sure. You know, I think he enjoys being coached by his brother.
Yeah.
Louisville's going to have a heck of a team
next year.
And, you know, if Michael Bush comes back and they're sitting there with Anthony Allen.
Yeah, they're going to have a chance to compete for it all.
Yep. Boy, and Louisville is such a special program for the Brohm family. Brian's dad played at Louisville. His two brothers played at Louisville. Of course, his older brother Jeff's his quarterback's coach now, had a great career there in collegiate game. This is Colby Smith, tackled at the 40-yard line by Alfonso Smith.
You know, I think when you look at these two programs, you know, Wake Forest, unless some miracle happens here, they're going to lose this football game tonight. But what a season they have had.
Yeah.
I mean, you talk about a season, 11 wins, and I know their fans are disappointed tonight, but
6-0 on the road, right?
Yeah, and going into Tallahassee, beating Florida State 30-0. I mean, I never thought I'd live long enough to see that.
And yet Jim Grobe has been able to keep the balance in his life. We talk about every single day he goes out during the season. He goes out for a walk with his wife, Holly, at noon. They go to the movies together. On Thursday night, he sends his coaches home right after practice. I mean, they work hard, but he's trying to really, really get some balance in his life and his coach's life.
Yeah, and you walk over to the other side and you see Bobby Petrino and what a job this guy has done at Louisville. I mean, they are so talented.
You know, the Cardinals people are going to have a hard time kind of fending off all these NFL rumors, too, because Bobby Petrino is one of the hottest coaching names in the country. We know about all the NFL openings already. There are likely to be some more. And you know that Bobby Petrino's name, whether it's right or wrong, is going to be bandied about quite a bit for some of these opportunities.
I'm just not sure about the allure of some of these pro jobs when you've got it going at a college like he has at Louisville. And you can recruit to, what, 8 number one draft picks every year.
Colby Smith takes the carry. Stopped at the 42-yard line. A reminder coming up, the DirecTV postgame show. We'll talk to the winners, have the trophy presentation, reveal the MVP of tonight's game, and much more. Our All-State Good Hands play of the game. How about Harry Douglas taking the chuck, beating Kevin Patterson for a big gainer, part of a FedEx Orange Bowl record-tying evening for Harry Douglas.
You kind of gave away the MVP already, didn't you? Didn't you already give away the MVP?
We're going to give away a couple of MVPs. Okay. We've got some FedEx packages for you and Terry to send your stuff back home to Southern California.
Fantastic. We certainly need to thank Fred Smith, the founder of FedEx, and the FedEx people. They've been just wonderful all week long down here in Florida. It's been a great trip. They've been tremendous.
Well, here's some numbers, and this will certainly back up what we were talking about when you talk about the highest active winning percentages in college football. And everybody on that list we just showed you seems to be rumored for every NFL job that comes down the pike. I can't see Pete Carroll leaving Southern California to go to Phoenix. But, you know, who knows? Yeah. It's great water cooler discussion, if nothing else.
You know, Bobby Petrino comes from a long line of coaches. His father was a coach at Carroll College for almost 3 decades. In the NAIA Hall of Fame, Bobby was telling me this week his dad was an innovative coach and actually wrote a book on option football. You know, he's a coach. His brother's a coach. His son, Nick, just won as a quarterback at the high school there in Louisville, just won the state championship. There's a whole bunch of football coaches in that family.
And, Terry, we talk about what Wake Forest has overcome. You know, Louisville is well en route to a FedEx Orange Bowl victory here today. These guys lose a Heisman Award candidate in the season opener. They were without Brian Brohm for 2 games. They, too, have really overcome a lot to get here.
No question about it. Michael Bush arguably was the best back in college football when he came here.
This is Brock Bolin up ahead to the 47-yard line as time continues to tick away on the Wake Forest Demon Deacons tonight. For the Louisville Cardinals, this would be their first BCS victory in their first BCS Bowl appearance. And yeah, Michael Bush is going to participate in the Gatorade ceremony as well.
Well, you mentioned the Big East and the undefeated record they're going to have in bowl season. Michael Bush is getting into it, isn't he?
Look at those guys over there conniving. Yeah. You know, they connive. They always want to get the poor head coach. He's sitting there not paying any attention, and they just attack him.
Coaches don't mind this moment at all.
They love it.
He knew it was coming, too. He's watched all that Parcells tape.
Oh, he just said it's not over with yet.
Crack a smile, coach.
I think it's over. 31 seconds. Yeah. I think he's got this one in the bag.
He knows a hyena doesn't laugh.
It's going to be a double bucket job. You know, there's another something here. The fact that this current Cardinal team didn't really suffer from this baggage coming into the FedEx Orange Bowl tonight. But Louisville had lost 14 straight in the state of Florida. Their only win here in this state was at Florida State back in 1952. Those are the kind of records that current players don't really look at with any kind of pertinence at all. But it remains a landmark victory for this Louisville program.
He is a good coach.
Well, and they had so many Florida players on their team, you know, and so this was a big, big game for their players and also for their future recruiting.
Well, let's face it, it's a 3-hour recruiting commercial when you can come to this state with so much talent down here and put on the kind of show that Louisville has.
What team doesn't have a bunch of Florida players on?
Good point.
That's my second of 2007. Thank you, Terry.
Louisville has 23 scholarship players that hail from the state of Florida. Wake Forest has 19 of them. Left. Colby Smith, the ball carrier. He stopped. Giles Tucker making the tackle for Wake. And if this game is going to end, it's going to end with the Wake offense perhaps on the field.
Bobby's still coaching right to the very end.
You
huh?
bet. Absolutely.
Yeah, I'm not sure why you wouldn't punt that ball. I guess number two, you'd worry about number two coming around, you know.
Getting a block, yeah.
But normally you'd punt that ball in that situation.
Well, Louisville is going to finish the season with their first ever top five ranking in the polls. Skinner's pass is caught on the sideline by John Tereshinski. He wants a flag. He wants some help on the sideline. They're not stopping yet. Wake wants to keep going. But that's going to do it tonight. Congratulations to Bobby Petrino and the Louisville Cardinals. Winners in the 73rd annual FedEx Orange Bowl. You know, 5-6 years ago, if you had talked about Louisville winning a BCS game, you'd have thought that they, the Louisville Cardinals, would have been the Cinderella story. They're a power now in college football.
Yeah, they are no longer the little engine that could. They're among the elite in college football.
But 20 years ago, this was a program that was on the verge of losing its Division 1A status. Just a few years ago, they played in the less competitive Conference USA, and what a job Bobby Petrino has done here in Louisville. Do stay with us. The trophy presentation and the MVP to be revealed when we come back.
Welcome to the DirecTV postgame show on Fox.
Welcome back to Miami. The 73rd annual FedEx Orange Bowl is done with a Cardinals victory over the Demon Deacons of Wake Forest. Let's take you down to the field and send it to Chris Rose.
All right, Matt, thank you very much. It is time for the trophy presentation. For that, I turn it over to the president of the 73rd FedEx Orange Bowl, Al Dotson Jr. Al?
First coach, the Big East champions, and now the champions of the 73rd annual FedEx Orange Bowl game. Congratulations.
Thank you very much. And thank you, Louisville fans. Woo!
Coach, a school record, 12 wins. You're finishing in the top 10 for the second time in 3 years. Is there any question this program is now a perennial power?
Well, we are. We're getting there, no question about it, and we're so happy to be in the Orange Bowl. Just a first-class organization. Everybody that worked for the Orange Bowl did a great job, and thank you very much.
You know, late in the season, Louisville, West Virginia, Rutgers, all unbeaten. Everybody said, yeah, but they're in the Big East. What do you say to everybody now?
What's the Big East record in the bowl game?
That would be 4-0.
4-0, you bet.
You know, Coach, I know it was an outstanding effort, obviously, defensively, offensively. Harry Douglas had a great game, but you got a real special kid in your quarterback, Brian Brohm.
Yeah, Brian had a great game, but I'm so proud of our entire team. That's what's made us strong all year long, is that we play good offense, good defense, and special teams came through, and we're a good team, and that's been our strength.
Coach, congratulations. Time right now for the individual honors, and for that I bring in Dan J. Mullally, Senior Vice President of Sales for FedEx. Dan?
Chris, thanks a lot. Great game again tonight. And on behalf of more than 270,000 FedEx employees and contractors, proud to present the 2007, the 73rd FedEx Orange Bowl MVP to Brian Brohm from the University of Louisville. Brian, congratulations, man. Great. Great job. Great job.
Brian, congratulations. I know last year it was tough for you. You didn't get to play in the bowl game. Obviously, what does tonight mean to you?
This is huge. This is huge for, you know, the whole program here at Louisville. We have the best fans in the nation, came out, supported us. It was a great win for our program.
You know, you have so much talent and young talent at that. You got to figure this would be a national championship contender next year. During the commercial break, they were chanting, "One more year." Will Brian Brohm be coming back for one more year?
It looks very appealing right now. It does. We got a great team coming back, and, you know, it'll be hard to pass up coming back for them.
Brian, Louisville Cardinals, congratulations. You are the 2007 FedEx Orange Bowl champions. Matt Vasgersian, back to you.
Chris, thanks. Only Tom Brady and Matt Leinart have thrown for more FedEx Orange Bowl yardage than Brian Brohm's 311 yards tonight. We're back from Miami right after this.
Welcome back to the DirecTV postgame show on Fox.
Welcome back to Miami, where Louisville has defeated Wake Forest 24-13. A lot of big nights by the Louisville Cardinals, and Laura Oakman is standing by with one who had a huge evening receiving.
Thanks, guys. A very happy Harry Douglas. You can smile now. You know that. A career-high 10 catches for 165 yards. One of the cool things all week, players have been saying the great thing about the season is that we're not following history, we're making history. How big is this win, Harry?
It's real big for our program. Brings our program. We're already on the uprise, and it's making us a national powerhouse by winning this game.
We all see how special your quarterback is, but for those of us who do not catch passes from him, what makes him so special?
He's a smart quarterback. He's smart. He knows where to put the ball. If a defender on us, he knows where to throw the ball so the defender don't hit us too hard. So I love him.
An Orange Bowl, tying an Orange Bowl record, 10 catches. I see why you love him. Congratulations, Harry. Back to you.
Laura, thanks. You know, with so much talent on this Louisville roster, and you know, the question was asked of Brian Brohm by Chris Rose, you coming back for another year? I mean, the Raiders need a quarterback. The Lions are looking. All these teams that have their eyes on Brian Brohm. You don't want to take away from the victory like this, but the question needs to be asked, who among these guys is going to be back in 2007?
Well, I think he indicated and played his hand that he was coming back, and if he does, they'll be a real contender for the national championship.
I think he'll want to win a national championship, and I think Louisville will be a contender.
Stick around with us. More from Miami. Our coverage continues here at the FedEx Orange Bowl. We'll be back with more right after this.
You take a K and an E, N and a T, U and a C-K-Y. That spells Kentucky, and it means paradise.